This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
And now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Thank you very much, Fred Foy. Hello, everybody. Welcome to episode pod 77 of The Glowing Dial with Big John and Steve. I am Big John, and over there is, well, wait a minute now. Where is he? Oh, I think he's getting ready to make one of his spectacular entrances. Okay, let's let him do that. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Steve, Archive Urbanic.
Ta-da!
Oh, are you all right?
Oh.
Get up there and get in your chair there.
Oh, yeah.
So
I gotta stop doing that.
You're getting old. We're both getting old. You got a birthday in, exactly 1 month from today. No, that's Stu's. September. You got 4 months from now.
Yes, it's still a ways away. Yet.
Yeah, Stu's is August 7th. That's right.
Yes.
And that's past this time. So we're past Stu's birthday. We're into the next episode here of The Glowing Dial. We do so many of these at a time here, so just so we can stay ahead. Well, this episode of The Glowing Dial, Big Steve.
I'm Big Steve now, huh?
Well, okay. All right, you got a bit of a pot belly going on there, you know. So,
Big Steve and John, yes.
Yes, yeah. We celebrate Labor Day and sing... Are you going to do it?
Labor? What?
We sing, whoa, ho, ho, it's magic.
Oh, that's right. This episode is all about magic.
Yes.
All the shows have something to do with magic.
And that's, of course, what was the song called? Just Magic?
Magic by Pilot.
Pilot, yeah. Back in 75.
75. Okay. The summer of 1975.
That's back when my neighbor and I used to ride up to the Kmart store on our bikes and pick up the latest 10 or so singles when they were 45s, when they were only like 50 cents. So, you know, for $5, you can get 10 of them.
Mm-hmm.
Those were the days.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one of the ones I picked up there. Of course, we had to get our frozen slushy drink too while we're up there. Mm. And the Kmart now is an MJR theater.
Yes,
you and I went to that one, didn't we? To see the Star Trek.
Yes, yeah. We have seen that. It's in there. Yes, since
the last Star Trek film.
Yes, there's far and few Kmart's around anymore, and this is where Kmart's first started. Was in metropolitan Detroit.
They had their world headquarters.
Garden City is the very first one, and that one is even closed now. The original Kmart is now closed too.
We went to one last year, and it was dead. I mean, it was just like, okay, this thing is in its death throes. They didn't have much of anything, not much of a selection of anything. This is a store taking its last breath. And I think they also owned Kresge's too, didn't they? Didn't they actually use the same K logo for that too?
S.S. Kresge, Sebastian Spirian Kresge, There's a trivia question for you guys. Had his 5 and 10 cent store,
mm-hmm.
Kresge's, for years, and Kmart came out as a spinoff from that.
Oh, Kmart spun out of that. Okay.
Yes, Kresge's was first. It's been around for over 100 years, and that one spun off of that. The Kmart headquarters was in Troy for a number of years,
right.
And that was on Big Beaver and Coolidge. And right across the street on the south side was the Kresge Mansion, and it's got a Michigan historical placard in front of the building.
Shows
the original Kresge Landholm or whatever.
Historical marker.
Historical marker, yes. I remember when I was young when Sebastian Spyrian Kresge died. It was 1967, so I was young, but I remember that.
I often thought it would be a great idea if we had those placards at areas in the state where something really funny happened.
Funny happened?
We could call them hysterical markers.
Okay, I think I'll have the emoji with the tongue sticking out right there.
Yes, indeed. Thank you, Uncle Josh. All right, well, we got to get to it because we got a lot of shows to bring you here, more than the usual Glowing Dial episode. Some of these are rather short, so that's why we can get more of them in. But they all have to do with magic.
Ta-da!
We're going to get to the first of those in just a moment, but Steve's got the first selection of celebrity birthdays.
I do. That's why I got married. Oh.
And I'll pronounce you co-host and birthdays.
We start off with August the 19th in the year of 1903. Franz Stryker. I know it sounds like a violent first last name there, but it's his last
Striking.
Name. Franz Stryker from Buffalo, New York. He was the creator and writer of The Lone Ranger,
mm-hmm.
Sergeant Preston of the Yukon, and The Green Hornet. And all of them originated at our local affiliate, WXYZ in Detroit.
Which is now WXYT.
The radio station still has the Z, but the T is now the television station. Next, we move to August the 20th, 1907. Alan Reed, also known as Teddy Bergman, from New York City. Actor, he was Falstaff Openshaw on The Fred Allen Show, Pasquale on Life with Luigi, and he was the very famed voice of Fred Flintstone on the animated series The Flintstones.
And I think for a while he was Shrevey the cab driver on The Shadow, too.
He was around a long time in many different roles.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And if you ever saw him, he kind of looked like a live-action Fred Flintstone would have looked like.
I seen him on, he was one of the guests one time on The Addams Family. I remember him in one episode. Snap, snap.
Yeah.
August 21st, 1900, Ken Carpenter from Avon, Illinois was born. He was an announcer on Kraft Music Hall, One Man's Family, Edgar Berg and Charlie McCarthy Show. August 22nd, 1910, Leslie Woods, actor Mary Wesley on Boston Blackie, and she played Margot Lane on The Shadow.
And she was in, I think, the Inner Sanctum that we featured last time.
Okay, all right. And August the 23rd, 1922, George Kell from Swifton, Arkansas. He was a baseball announcer for the Detroit Tigers here. Since we're from Detroit, he's one of our mainstays on our local broadcasts of Tiger games. George Kell from Arkansas.
One of three familiar voices of the Tigers on radio. You know when you heard George Kell, Paul Carey, or Ernie Harwell, you knew it was springtime and time for baseball again.
Mm-hmm.
It just, you know.
They were mainstays for many years here in the Motor City.
Every time Dad would be out in the yard working, doing some kind of yard work or something, always the transistor radio and always the Tiger game on. Well, I found it amazing that when we used to vacation up in the Mackinac Straits area, they got WJR all the way up there. Which later I realized was no surprise, because it's a 50,000-watt powerhouse.
It was one of the superstations.
Yes, yes.
Indicated by its three digits instead of four letters, three letters in its name.
You could
a super station.
Yeah, 50,000 watts at least.
Mm-hmm.
And you could hear it through on a good night through most of the country.
Yes, you could easily get, you know, out through the plain states easily with the broadcasts.
What other ones did we have? We had another one, the WWJ, mm-hmm. another three-letter, WGN, WOR.
You know, those are other cities, but yes.
WLS.
Those are super stations, only
yeah.
three letters in
mm-hmm.
there. Because on a clear night here in Detroit, I know I could pick up New Orleans. I picked up Oklahoma City a few times and Denver. So, I mean, those stations were also super stations picked up on the other end, received in Detroit. I'm sure our station received out at least as far as those communities as well.
I used to love doing that with TV. We had a rotor on our antenna back in the day before we went HD. And I used to love it late at night trying to see what stations I could pick up from how far away.
Mm-hmm.
And there were two Channel 8s, one and two Channel 5s, both from Cleveland. There were two 12s. I got Erie, Pennsylvania one night. I was like, wow, Erie, Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
And we're in the Detroit area in Michigan, you know. So it's
mm-hmm.
like, wow, that's pretty far away to be getting. So that was just an enjoyable thing to do. And you can do the same. That's called DXing. You can do it with radio these days. With AM radio, you can still do it. But not with TV so much anymore, now that it's all gone digital and you don't have that AM skip thing helping the signal to propagate anymore. But anyway, that was a fun thing while it lasted. So let's move on, Steve. We've got the birthdays out of the way. It's time for our first magical show.
Magic! Bling.
Whoa, ho, ho. It's magic. Never believe it's not so.
Make it so.
Or it's magic, you know, never believe it's
number
not
one,
so.
Number one, make it yeah. so.
Is that what Picard said about an old sewing machine?
Make it so.
Yes, make it so.
My singer doesn't work, make it so. Yeah.
What do you want to be, a singer or a captain of a ship? You know, make up your mind. I can't hear Picard being a singer, I just can't.
He just says the words, he doesn't sing them. And right. here's to you, Mrs. Robinson. Jesus loves you more than you should know.
Of course, whoa, he could officiate whoa. At a wedding, you know. He could just, the way he always said, engage.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right, enough about that. Mandrake the Magician is the show we've got lined up for you first. And
oh, it's a show? I thought it was a comic strip.
Both.
Oh.
It's called Captain X, Lothar, and Tommy Escape. Mm-hmm. From Wednesday, February 26, 1941, over Mutual. And it features Raymond Edward Johnson and Juano Hernandez, the fellow that burped. If you remember us talking about that little incident that Bob Hastings related to us, check Bob Hastings' interview in the Glowing Dial Archives, and you'll hear the Juano Hernandez burp story. This series was sustained at this point in time as well. Steve, you've got a little bit of information for us on Mandrake the Magician.
And then some, yes. Mandrake the Magician. Comic strips and superheroes go together like ice cream and sprinkles. But there was a time when there were no superheroes on the comic pages. Superman and Captain Marvel first appeared in 1938 and 39, respectively, or some of the earliest costumed crime fighters. But there was an even earlier superhero. King Features' Mandrake the Magician began appearing in newspaper comic pages in 1934. Unlike the Man of Steel and later costumed crime fighters, Mandrake never had to rely on a secret identity, but he had plenty of superpowers, many of which came in handy for his day job as a stage magician. Both his act and much of his crime fighting were based on an unusually fast hypnosis technique. By simply gesturing hypnotically, Mandrake was able to make the audience and his enemies see what he wanted them to see. Mandrake the Magician was adapted for a Mutual Network series beginning in November of 1940. Mandrake was played by Raymond Edward Johnson, who had developed his radio talents working with Arch Obler on Lights Out, and would go on to create the role of Raymond, the morbid horror host of Hyman Brown's Inner Sanctum Mysteries. Mandrake the Magician began as a 15-minute serial, 3 days a week, and was expanded to 5 days per week in 1941. Like many other adventure stories for youngsters of the period, many of Mandrake's foes were agents of fascism and Nazism, and he spent more time chasing saboteurs and submarines than he would expect for a stage magician. Mandrake's loyal sidekick was a large and powerful African prince, Lothar. In the early comic strips, Lothar wore a fez and a leopard skin, and on the radio, his speech pattern was similar to Tantos from The Lone Ranger. The magician also had a recurring love interest in Princess Narda, who was from the small European kingdom of Cockaigne, ruled benevolently by her brother Sigrid. Narda was played by Francesca Lenny, but for a time, stage actress Jessica Tandy filled the role. The show ran until February 1942, with Mandrake and Lothar traveling the world, working magic, righting wrongs, and making the world a safer and better place.
Anyway, okay, let us, we've talked enough here, let us get this program underway. Stephen, McGee Machine, please.
Yeah, the McGee Machine is here. Let me go down and twiddle this dial here, because that's where I know I'll find Mandrake. And here it comes. It's magic.
You know, don't believe it's not so, yeah. So sit back, close your eyes, and remember, Mandrake the Magician, this is Captain X, Lothar, and Tommy Escape. From Wednesday, February 26, 1941, originally over Mutual.
We're so deep, Jefferson, that when Lothar and Tommy hit the water, it'll be like feeding them to a rock crusher. Captain X calling control room.
Hi, sir. Pilot speaking.
All right, listen. When you receive an order over the tube to flood the escape chamber and open the automatic door, obey it without question.
Hi, sir.
Pretend you're Pilot Dorfman. Say you're so close to the surface that the periscope is almost showing. Got that?
Hi, sir.
We seem to have this section of the submarine to ourselves. Huh. It's a better break than I expected.
Door with heavy glass window. This escape chamber, Master?
That's right, Lothar.
Oh, there's no knob on the door, Mr. Mandrake.
Everything works from the control room, Tommy.
Oh.
This speaking tube connects with it.
You're going to call the control room?
You bet I am, Tommy. I'm going to find out if my control over Dorfman is still working. Hello? Control room?
Control room. Pilot speaking.
Dorfman?
Dorfman. That's right.
How close to the surface are you running, Dorfman?
If I were any closer, the periscope would be showing above water.
Good. Make sure your valves are working smoothly. Then open the escape chamber door and stand by for orders.
Aye, sir.
Gosh, that was easy.
Yes. Yes, almost too easy. Funny, that didn't sound like Dorfman's voice.
Well, maybe it just sounded different over the speaking tube.
Maybe.
That's right, Tommy, but...
What, Master?
I don't like this sudden quiet. Captain X must have sounded the alarm. I expected to find every corridor swarming with sailors.
Escape chamber door open, Master.
Yes. Escape chamber. It could so easily become a death chamber if Captain X knew what I was planning.
Maybe Captain X is so sure we can't get away that... Well, he ordered his men to let you make the first move.
Maybe. Tommy's smart, Master.
Yes. Yes, you're right again, Tommy, of course, but... I'm always inclined to suspect a trap when everything is made too easy for me. I suppose it's all right. Yes. Yes, it must be.
We go in now, Master?
Wait. I want to make sure you and Tommy understand. Once you're inside, I'll order Dorfman to close the door and fill the chamber with water.
Gosh.
Afraid, Tommy?
Oh, no, sir. Not if you say it's all right.
If Master say all right, then all right, Tommy.
I'm sure it's all right.
Oh, all right.
Listen. I'll watch the chamber fill up with water through the glass panel in the door. Then I'll give Dorfman the order to open the outer door. Then you'll shoot to the surface. Lothar, the rest is up to you. Get Tommy to shore.
Lothar, understand.
Well, I can swim.
I know, Tommy, but you may be 5 miles from shore. Don't strike out for yourself. Stay close to Lothar.
Yes, sir.
What we do when... We'll get ashore, Master.
When you get ashore, notify the police what has happened as soon as you can reach the telephone. Tell them to throw a cordon around Barracuda's shack at Shore Point. Nard and Sigrid are prisoners there. Force Barracuda to contact this sub by radio and order Captain X to surrender.
Well, what about you, Master? What become of you?
I shall depend on the Mandrake Lock to hold just a little bit longer, Lothar. All right. Inside with you now, both of you.
Goodbye, Mr. Mandrake. Gosh, it's been swell knowing you.
Hmm?
I mean, I...
I know what you mean, Tommy. Inside you go.
All right, sir.
Control room.
Control room. Dorfman speaking.
Close the door to escape chamber.
Aye, sir.
It's starting to fill up. Wish I didn't have the horrible feeling that something was wrong. The feeling that I was sending Lothar and that boy to their death. The water is nearly up to Tommy's shoulder. They're both grinning at me through the glass as though they were going on a picnic. As game as they make 'em. I wonder what that sound was. Take a good long breath, both of you. Control room.
Speaking.
Escape chamber filled. Close valves.
Aye, sir.
Open outer escape hatch. Make it snappy.
Aye, sir.
There they go. Straight through the hatch. Close the escape hatch, Dorfman.
Aye, sir. All clear there now?
Yes, Dorfman. You can pump the water out.
And report to the radio cabin at once, Mandrake.
What's that, Dorfman?
This is not Dorfman. Captain X and Mr. Alex Jefferson are waiting for you, sir.
I see.
Will you come freely? Or will it be necessary to bring you in under guard? The captain says you have your choice.
I'll come freely. So I was right. That wasn't Dorfman who took my orders. I walked blindly into the trap Captain X set for me like any simpleton. And I've sent Lothar and that boy to their death. A horrible death, the life crushed out of them by tons of water. And now they intend to gloat. So Captain X and Alex Jefferson are waiting for me, are they? I don't think they're going to enjoy their next meeting with Mandrake the Magician.
Radio room. Captain X speaking.
Control room. Pilot, sir.
Did you deliver my message to Mandrake?
Yes, sir. He agreed to come freely, sir.
Good. He's got some sense.
Any further orders, sir?
Yes. Turn sub. Proceed up the coast at low speed. I want to be offshore point again by nightfall.
Aye, sir. Maintain same depth, sir.
10 fathoms deep until further orders, pilot.
Aye, sir.
I'm sending Mr. Jefferson ashore at Shore Point and taking on Barracuda's two prisoners, Narda and her brother Sigrid. We will then submerge and return to our base. I don't think Dorfman will recover, so you'll have to do double duty.
Aye, sir.
I'm going to contact Barracuda on Shore Point now and make sure there's no slip-up on tonight's plans.
Now look here, sister. Maybe you'd rather have me call you Narda. I don't like to see a good-looker's mouth spoiled by a gag. So if you promise to talk nice, I'll take it off. Just nod if that suits you. Well, that's fair enough. I'll have that rag out of your mouth in a jiffy. But I'm going to keep you tied up just on general principles. There you are, sister.
Oh, thank you, Mr.
Just Barracuda.
Thank you, Barracuda.
It's okay, Narda.
Won't you do as much for my brother's secret?
Nope. If anybody comes snooping around a point in a boat, I might have to slip that gag back on you in a hurry. I ain't taking no chances on one of you letting out a yell while I was shutting the other one's mouth, you see?
Where did you just go now?
Me? Oh, I just went down to look your airplane over. It's pretty well hid behind them trees.
Somebody may find it. And...
don't be getting your hopes up. Nobody comes up here much from that side. Hey, that plane's liable to rot before anybody ever finds it.
You're going to put us aboard that submarine after dark tonight, aren't you?
Yep, unless I get different orders. Say, might not be a bad idea to tune in on the short wave. Captain X might try to contact me again.
Couldn't anybody that happened to be in on your wavelength understand what you said?
Sure. But the air's all cluttered up with amateurs, passing the time of day. We don't say anything that would rouse no suspicions. Code might get somebody curious, so we don't use it, you see?
X calling Shorepoint.
There's a captain now. Listen, sister, and see how slick it's done. Hello, Shorepoint. Go ahead, X.
You were right, Shorepoint. Thanks for the tip. We did have two guests that we were unaware had paid us a visit.
He means Mandrake and Lothar. They've been discovered.
What'd you do with them?
We disposed of T and L.
Tommy and Lothar, he means.
How?
The water cure. Under pressure, if you know what I mean.
Sure. I got it.
Tommy, Lothar, killed.
How about the other one?
Mandrake.
We intend to let him amuse us for a while longer. We're waiting for him now.
Swell.
It should be quite a reunion when your guests meet mine tonight.
Yeah, I get it. Everything stands?
Everything stands.
Be seeing you, X.
I won't contact you again. Signing off, Shorepoint.
Okay. Hey, you see how it works, sister? No code. Just a little harmless double talk that wouldn't interest nobody listening.
No, I don't suppose it would. But somebody might be interested if they heard a cry for help.
Don't try that.
Help! Help! I'm being held a prisoner at Shaw.
You little devil-crosser. This gag stays in your mouth until you get aboard that sub. And I hope Captain X feeds you to the fishes, too.
Hi there, this is Bill Bragg, the man with a million friends. And you're listening to The Glowing Dial with my good friends Big John and Steve.
And welcome back to The Glowing Dial. I'm Big John, that's Steve. This is episode pod 77, in which we are celebrating Labor Day and singing Whoa Ho Ho, It's Magic, with all kinds of magical programs. We just heard Mandrake the Magician, Captain X, Lothar, and Tommy Escape from Wednesday, February 26, 1941, over Mutual. And we have some more magic shows to bring you. Just briefly want to let you know about the Glowing Dial Live. Yes, we're hoping to keep bringing you the live show. And now that Steve is available, he might be making some appearances on some live shows. It's going to be every third Sunday of the month is the plan, from 4 to 7 p.m. Eastern. You can talk with us via our chat room, via phone, or via Skype as well. You can win some cool prizes in the form of a USB stick with some old-time radio programs from the Glowing Dial Archives. And we feature an audio-only feed through our good friends at Mixlr.com, as well as a YouTube and a Facebook video feed. So you can see what these crazy people look like as we're doing the show. So be sure to check the website, glowingdial.com. Click on live show on the menu to the left, and you'll see all the latest information on that. And because, you know, we due to my illness, we had gotten behind on the Glowing Dial. And one note on that, episodes pod 71 through 74 will be recorded. The ones that we missed, we will record them, and we will put them immediately in the archive shows section so you can still listen to them. They won't be quite as topical, but they should still be equally as entertaining, though. So we hope you'll check that out, and we're going to get those four shows cut just as soon as we can and get those up there for you. So make sure you check back at the archive shows page, and we'll put them up as they are ready. All right. That having been said, Steve, it's time for our next show. It's called Blackstone Magic Detective. This is called Crimes on a Merry-Go-Round. And this is from Sunday, September 11th, 1949, over Mutual and in syndication. It's Ed Jerome, stars as Blackstone, with Fran Carlin and Alan Kent, who also is announcing. The sponsor, of course, varied due to syndication. I think you have a little bit of information there, or maybe a lot of bit.
Yeah.
A lot of bit of information on Blackstone Magic Detective. Here's Steve with that.
Blackstone, the Magic Detective, was a 15-minute radio series based on Elmer Cecil Stoner's short-lived comic series, Blackstone, Master Magician. It also was based on real-life magician Harry Blackstone Sr., the world's greatest living magician. The program aired Sunday afternoons at 2:45 p.m. on the Mutual Broadcasting System from October 3, 1948 until March 26, 1950. Scripts were mostly by Walter B. Gibson, the ghostwriter of Blackstone's books, and Nancy Webb, who worked with Gibson on Chick Carter, Boy Detective. Gibson is most fondly remembered as the creator of The Shadow. The show usually opened with Blackstone talking with his assistant Rhoda Brent and her friend John. Each show begins with John finding an object in Blackstone's magic studio, from a chainsaw to a talking skull to a fishbowl. Much like the Orson Welles radio show, The Black Museum, the object prompts a vivid story of mystery. Blackstone and Rhoda reminisce to their friend John about their tales of adventure and how magic saved the day. Sometimes, in place of the character of John, announcers Don Hancock or Alan Kent would play themselves and be a part of the conversation. After the mystery's climax, the narrative returned to the three main characters as Blackstone performed a magic trick. After a commercial break handled by the announcer, Blackstone returned to demonstrate and explain the trick so that listeners could perform it for the amusement of their family and friends.
All right, thank you. And then some of those tricks were just very basic magic store things that kids could buy. You know, the little kits you used to be able to get. Amaze your family and friends.
Well,
make the Ace of Spades appear and rest the death card.
Remember, John, the line is tricks are for kids. It's not for adults.
Silly co-host. I like the way your jokes come wabbit fire. Wabbit. Wabbit twax.
Be very, very quiet.
Wabbit season. Duck season. Wabbit season. Duck season. Elmer season. Yes, can you tell we grew up with Warner Brothers animation? Anyway, let's tune this show in, Steve.
Okay, McGee Machine, please bring me magic, magic. I'm looking for magic.
Blackstone magic Blackstone, detective we're looking for.
The magic detective. Can you give me some, please? Here it goes.
Oh, yes. Sit back, close your eyes, and remember Blackstone Magic Detective. Crimes on Merry-Go-Round from Sunday, September 11, 1949, over Mutual and in syndication.
Detective, starring the world's greatest living magician, Blackstone. He tells you the inside story of Crimes on a Merry-Go-Round. And right after the story, Blackstone will explain tricks that you yourself can perform. Reveal the guarded secrets of the world's greatest living magician. Stand by for Blackstone, the Magic Detective. What on earth are you two doing?
Playing ring toss.
Ring toss?
Uh-huh.
Well, those are the smallest rings I've ever seen. They look more like the ones you get on a merry-go-round than quoits.
Well, that's exactly what they are. Rhoda and I are just having a little game with them, Alan.
Well, you're not supposed to bring those things home from the merry-go-round, you know. You're supposed to throw them back.
Oh, these are our own. They were given to us.
An odd sort of present, I must say.
Well, these are an odd sort of ring.
Why, no, they're not. They're just the usual merry-go-round rings.
That's what the police thought, too, Alan.
Well, what have the police got to do with them?
They gave them to us.
Look, unless I'm awfully wrong, you're all talking double talk.
Well, you're wrong. But, Blackstone, perhaps you better tell Alan the story.
All right, I will. Well, the police came to me one morning, Alan, and asked me to investigate a dope ring. They had traced the dope to a carousel that played in the park. And they had traced the dope away from the merry-go-round, but they couldn't find the connecting link. That was my job. So Rhoda and I set out the carousel.
Golly, there it is. Uh-huh. You know, I think no matter how old you are, that sound always means excitement.
Yes, it seems to take you back to the days when riding on a merry-go-round was the greatest thrill in the world.
Well, I guess I'm a perpetual ingenue then. It still is the greatest thrill for me.
Now, look, kid, you shut up.
But he took it. He took my ring.
Well, you weren't supposed to swipe it anyway.
I grabbed it, didn't I? I guess I won it, I guess. And the man just took it away from
me. Well, look
me.
Here, you. You stop that quarter walling. You get away from here. Say, with the racket of the merry-go-round going all the time, that's all the noise I can stand. Now, you either shut up or scram, see?
What's the matter, kid?
Oh, he tried to swipe one of them brass rings to the merry-go-round, and one of the guards made him give it back.
It wasn't no guard. It was just a guy. And he put it in his own pocket.
Two adults, one child, please.
Child, who's that for?
I thought we might take our tragic young friend here for another spin.
Oh, gee, mister, that's swell.
Come on then, young one.
Say, thanks for taking them away. I couldn't stand that crying no more.
Oh, look, Blackstone. There's a zebra, just like the one on the carousel at home. I want to ride on that.
All right, you go ahead. I'm going to travel more sedately in this chariot.
Oh, that's sissy stuff. It just stands still. We like the ones that go up and down.
I'm going to ride on the rooster. I rode on the zebra last time.
Okay. Up you go.
Thanks, miss.
Now, me for my zebra. Hey, quit that shoving.
Out of my way, out of my way.
That's my zebra. I'm going to ride on it.
That's what you think, lady. I got it.
Oh, now, come on. I used to ride on that zebra when I was a kid, and I...
Stand it, lady. You ain't a kid no more, and I'm riding it.
Come back here with me, Rhoda.
All the other seats are taken, so I guess I'll have to, but I did want to ride on that zebra. Blackstone, did you ever see anything like that guy?
Maybe he rode on a zebra, too, when he was a kid.
Yeah, maybe. They looked more like the ostrich type to me.
Hey, lady, that's the bum that stole my ring.
Huh?
Whee! Here we go!
Rhoda, I want you to get off. Huh? Quick, before the merry-go-round goes too fast.
But...
Call O'Reilly at headquarters. Tell him to be here fast.
But...
Hurry now.
Okay, boss.
Hey, where'd the lady go?
Oh, she had to make a phone call. But you and I'll have our ride. What do you say now? Let's try to catch the rings, eh?
Okay. Whee! Oh, I almost got one.
Good. Well, now, try again.
Hey, gosh, that mean guy on the zebra's got one.
Yeah, well, now you see if you can.
And he's got another. He's throwing it back into the clown's mouth now. But he kept the first one.
Yes, so I noticed.
And now he's got another.
And he isn't throwing that one back either.
Whee! I got one.
Good for you.
The guy on the zebra missed it.
May I see it, Petey?
Well, sure, mister. Here you are.
Thank you. I think I'll keep this one, Petey, if you don't mind. I'll give you another ride for it.
Oh, gee, swell.
You stay on, kid. I'll arrange with the cashier. I want to arrange for our young friend here to have another ride, miss.
Sure.
Go inside the booth.
I beg your pardon?
None of that. Get inside there, like I said. This hand in my pocket means business. I can shoot from the hip.
Say, what do you mean bringing that guy in here? Now, I told you to stay away from me while you're on the job.
Hand over that ring.
I don't know what you're talking about.
I said hand it over.
Now, really, don't you think this is going a little too far?
Don't give me none of your lip. I saw you pocket the ring the kid grabbed from me.
What do you want with it?
That's none of your business.
I think it is.
My trigger finger's itching, mister.
Now listen, you. I don't want no killings around here.
Sure, I don't know what this is all about. But if you'll just let me out of here...
Not till you give me that ring.
Very well. Here it is.
The feel of a gun in some guy's ribs always makes him cough up, huh? Hey, this ain't the right ring.
I beg your pardon?
Don't go on saying I beg your pardon all the time. This ain't the right ring. I tell you...
Now you see what you've done. That guy was just swiping the ring and you go and act up like this. You got us all in trouble. This guy'll sing to the cops just as sure as soon as he gets out of here.
He ain't getting out of here. Not alive, that is.
Well, you ain't got about nobody in here.
I'll give you one more chance, mister. Do you want to go out under your own power or do you want to be carried out? It's up to you.
I'm sure I don't know what you're talking about. I gave you the ring you asked for, and
if that's the way you want to play it, take a deep breath. It's going to last you a long time.
Now, not in here, you don't.
One, two.
He's in there. I can see him, officer.
The cops.
Well, this guy ain't going to be alive to meet him.
No? Well, take that.
We're coming, Blackstone.
Now, I've got your gun. Stand back, both of you. All right, O'Reilly. Here's your dope peddler. And here's a little dope to use as evidence.
Tell me, Blackstone, what did the rings have to do with the dope, and how did you know?
Well, it was very simple, really, Alan. So simple that it... Well, it was almost foolproof.
Until you came along, that is.
We knew that the merry-go-round was where the peddlers were getting their merchandise. But we didn't know how or from whom. Until we met the little boy, Pete. He gave me my first clue. I realized that there was some very great importance attached to those rings.
After all, a man wouldn't take one away from a kid just for fun.
And then, when the crook insisted on grabbing the seat Rhoda had wanted and made such a scene about it, it all connected in my mind.
Well, it hasn't in mine, yes.
Well, a lot of those rings were hollow. The man who put them into the slot loaded them with dope. He timed them so that the doped ones would come down just as the zebra passed. Our friend would pocket the ring instead of throwing it into the clown's mouth.
But what if someone else got one instead?
Petey did, by accident. Now, most people would have tossed the ring back, but Petey kept his. Generally, no one wanted them.
Blackstone watched the crook on my zebra and saw him palming some of the other rings he took. And he very ostentatiously took the one from Petey and put it in his pocket so the crook could see him do it.
Palming? Mm-hmm. Gee, I wish I could do that. It always seemed just like magic. Well, so that's how another mystery was solved by magic.
Yes, Alan.
And now, Blackstone, what is the trick?
Well, the next trick I call gravity defied.
You mean it's going to make us laugh?
I mean I'm going to make you pop-eyed with amazement using the simplest of appliances, this coin.
That's a half dollar.
Now watch. I take the half dollar between the thumb and finger of my right hand.
And then?
I set it here upon the fingers of my left, holding the left palm upward.
You're setting the coin on edge. That's
right. And
it's
just about halfway along your fingers.
When I take my right hand away, what happens?
But the coin is standing there, balanced.
On the fingers of your left hand.
Say, that is a trick.
Only a trick, Rhoda.
Well, yes, you haven't exactly defied gravity simply by balancing a coin.
You mean you're expecting something more remarkable?
Sure.
Well, watch the coin.
Say, it's beginning to tilt that one.
And slowly, too. You'd think the coin was alive.
Well, that's the magic in it. Gradually, the coin is lying down. Slowly, slowly, until...
It's flat on your fingers.
Blackstone, what's come over that coin?
Hey, can we have a look at it?
Of course. Here, Rhoda, take it.
But what about your fingers? Can we look at them?
Why, certainly. They're full of invisible magnetism, but they won't hurt you, Alan.
Well, what bothers me is how the trick worked. Do you think I could ever figure it out, Blackstone?
Well, I'll give you a few minutes to try, Rhoda. And if you don't, I'll be back to tell you all about
Blackstone, I want to know what made that coin behave the way it did.
You won't have to look far to find out, Rhoda. It's right here on the floor.
Well, what's on the floor? An electromagnet?
No, something a lot less complicated. An ordinary pin.
Uh-huh.
Ah, here it is.
Just an ordinary pin? How could that control the coin?
Well, here's how. Before the trick, I gripped the pin like this.
Let's see. Oh, yeah, between the lower knuckles of your first two fingers.
Between the first two fingers of the left hand. That's where I hold the head of the pin.
Oh, yeah, I see. And the point is projecting inward.
Which is why I didn't close my left hand too tight.
Hmm.
Now for the trick. I show the coin with my right hand and bring it over to my left.
Why, are you sitting the coin right against the pin?
Only we can't see the pin. That's why we didn't know it was there.
I remove my right hand and the coin stays balanced. Now, watch it tilt.
But why does it do that?
I simply relax my fingers and the weight of the coin bears down upon the pin until they both are flat.
So now you can pass the coin to be examined.
Exactly. And when I open the fingers of my left hand,
The pin drops to the floor where you never look for it.
Never, unless we knew. And now we know.
I hope you like that trick, ladies and gentlemen. And so, until next time, this is Blackstone wishing you good magic and goodbye. Be with us next time when the world's greatest living magician, Blackstone, tells us the story of the magic writing and explains more tricks that you yourself can perform. Listen in again to Blackstone, the world's greatest living magician.
Hi, this is Frank Brzee, Little Beaver on Old Time Radio's Red Rider. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
It's Big John and it's Steve, and welcome back to The Glowing Dial, episode pod 77, where we're celebrating Labor Day and singing, Whoa, Ho, Ho, It's Magic. And you notice I didn't sing that, and be happy that I didn't, because I can't carry a tune in a bucket with a good-sized handle or anything like that. Sand and a shovel, maybe, but a tune, no. We just heard Blackstone Magic Detective, Crimes on a Merry-Go-Round, from Sunday, September 11, 1949, and that was over Mutual and in syndication. We have plenty more magic shows to bring you, but first, we have some more celebrity birthdays. And guess who gets to do those? All right, we start this section with August 24th, 1896. Cyril Armbrister, producer-director of Shandu the Magician. Oh, what do you know? We have that coming up next. Strange as it Seems in Terry and the Pirates. August 25, 1909, Mr. Michael Rennie from Bradford, Yorkshire, England. He was an actor in Lux Radio Theatre, in Klaatu in The Day the Earth Stood Still on film. I think he was in the Third Man TV series with Jonathan Harris, I believe. So they had worked together before, and not just in that Lost in Space two-parter, The Keeper, but a fine actor. August 26, 1911, Hal Gibney from Woodland, California. He was the announcer on Dragnet, The Six Shooter, and Tales of the Texas Rangers. August 27, 1916, the Big Mouth herself, Martha Ray from Butte, Montana. She was a comedian and a very funny lady. Tuesday Night Party, Cavalcade of America, Screen Guild Theater, just to mention a few of them. And she was in an Abbott and Costello, one of their service pictures. And I'm trying to remember which one. I don't know that it was Buck Privates. It might have been one of the other service comedies. But she played twins, which were causing Bud and Lou all kinds of craziness because they thought she was just one girl, and it turns out that she's twins. August 28, 1925, Mr. Donald O'Connor, born in Chicago, Illinois.
A hoofer.
A comedian and an actor, and a hoofer, on The Jenny Sims Show, Philip Morris Playhouse, Suspense, and the Francis the Talking Mule films. And, I just, for the first time, saw some of those. Entertaining, you know, as were the Ma and Pa Kettle ones that we were talking about last episode. And that's it for now. We have some more celebrity birthdays coming up a little later on in the program. Right now, we have an episode of Shandu the Magician. This one is called Island of Disappearing Men. Maybe some evil women behind this plot.
Sounds like a plot, yeah.
Saturday, November 26, 1949 is the original air date there on ABC, and it's starring Tom Collins. Not the cocktail, just the actor.
Oh, okay.
Howard Culver is announcing, and the series was sustained. And, Steve, you have some information on Shandu for us.
Shandu? Instead of Candu, Shandu.
Okay, Operation Shandu.
Shandu the Magician, one of the longest-running radio adventure serials, was heard on several different networks and aired in two distinctly different series, one in the 1930s and a revival 12 years later in the 40s and 50s. The series was created by Harry A. Earnshaw and Raymond R. Morgan. The first version launched in 1931 on KHJ in Los Angeles. The series was soon heard through the West Coast when broadcast on the Don Lee Network. It was then heard over WOR in the East. Nationally, it aired over Mutual. The series was sponsored by White King Soap in the West and by Beechnut Gum in the East. Gain Whitman played the lead role of American-born Frank Chandler, who had learned occult secrets from a yogi in India. Known as Chandu, he possessed several supernatural skills, including astral projection, teleportation, and the ability to create illusions. Shandu's goal was to go forth with his youth and strength to conquer the evil that threatens mankind. His sister, Dorothy Regent, was portrayed by Margaret MacDonald. Cyril Armbruster directed the scripts by Vera Oldham, which took Shandu to far-flung locales, both real and mythical. Romantic interludes for Shandu were introduced with Egyptian Princess Naji, played by Viola Vaughn. Music was first furnished by Felix Mills and then Raymond Page. According to Viola Vaughn, the program was broadcast from the KHJ building on Melrose Avenue. The KHJ building is still standing, although the KHJ studios are no longer in use. In 1935, the production moved to WGN Chicago with a new cast, including Howard Hoffman as the title role and Cornelia Osgood as Dorothy. Her children, Bob and Betty, were played by Olin Soule and Audrey McGrath. When this series came to an end in 1936, WGN's productions of Shandu were transcribed in the Chicago facilities of the World Broadcasting System for use on other stations. In April 1935, they were being broadcast on one other station, WJR, in Detroit, Michigan. 12 years later, the series was revived on the Mutual Don Lee Network as a 15-minute weekday program starring Tom Collins as Shandu and Luis Van Ruten as the villainous Roxor, plotting world domination, with Howard Culver as the announcer and music by organist Corla Pandit. Eventually, the serial continuity was dropped in favor of 30-minute episodes, each with a self-contained storyline. Culver often read the commercials with Pandit's organ music in the background. In early 1949, Shandu the Magician moved to ABC, continuing the self-contained 30-minute format. The last broadcast was September 6, 1950. In 1932, Shandu the Magician was produced as a film with Edmund Lowe as Shandu and Bela Lugosi as Roxor. In The Return of Shandu, 1934, Lugosi portrayed Shandu.
That's okay, it. Okay, that's it. Alrighty, thank you, Steve.
Naturally.
And without further ado, let's get this program rolling for the good people.
Rolling, rolling, rolling.
Rolling, so we rolling. Want Shandu the Magician on the McGee Machine there.
Twiddle a dial to Shandu.
Think about
way
it
over here on this end. There.
Think about it clearly. That's how it tunes it in. All right, folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember Shandu the Magician. This is Island of Disappearing Men. From Saturday, November 26, 1949, originally over ABC.
Shandu, the Magician.
Give me the keys.
No, you must not open the door.
There's something hidden in that house, and I'm going to find out what it is.
No, Mr. Chandler, you must not. The house is accursed.
Accursed?
Always they are watching, the unseen eyes.
I came here to find out why men disappear on this island. If you know, tell me.
I cannot tell you.
Listen to me.
I can say no more. It is death to stay in that house.
In 60 seconds, the American Broadcasting Company will bring you the first act of Chandu, the Magician. What are your dreams for 10 years from now? Perhaps you'd like to travel abroad. In 10 years, comfortable tourist accommodations will certainly be available. This also applies if your travel plans are along the lines of See America First. If you're wondering how you can be sure of having the money at that time, buy savings bonds. Perhaps you haven't been considering travel. Well, if you've been counting on future leisure time or a college education for your children, a farm or business of your own, a retirement income or a home of your own, the solution is still the same. Buy savings bonds. Purchase them the easy, automatic way, where you work, through the payroll savings plan, where you bank, through the bond-a-month plan. Savings bonds are profitable. For every $3 invested today, you'll receive $4 when your bonds mature. So buy United States savings bonds through the payroll savings plan or bond-a-month plan. And remember, automatic saving is sure saving. Now tonight's story of magic and mystery. Since time began, men and women have had strange experiences for which there is no explanation, except in the secrets the ancient magicians knew. But for centuries, their secrets have been guarded in the hidden places of the Far East. Today, perhaps Frank Chandler has discovered them, as people say. He is called Chandu the Magician. Can you be sure it isn't true? Cairo, darkness. The house on the Pyramid Road is silent. But in the magic of the Egyptian night, a woman is dreaming. A vivid, terrifying dream. Chandu, the magician.
Look at me, woman. Speak the truth, you have found them.
No! No! This cave is an evil place. Let me go.
By the ancient bond between us, you will reveal what you have learned.
I know nothing.
Swear it by the god of the temple under the sea.
Let me go.
The water rises. The waves are breaking.
The waves! No! No! Mother!
Betty.
Mother.
Tell me.
I know not.
Go away. Go away.
The temple under the sea.
Go away. Go away. Go away.
Dorothy.
Go away.
Dorothy, wake up.
Go away.
Dorothy.
Frank.
You must have been having a nightmare.
No, no. They were in the cave.
The cave?
I couldn't see the woman's face, but... Oh, I was dreaming.
You certainly were.
Turn on the light, will you? Why, you're dressed. Haven't you been to bed?
No. I was writing a report, and then I got a cable from Washington.
I wonder if there really is anything in dreams.
Didn't you hear what I said?
And I'd like to know whether there's any such island as that.
As what?
Frank... I don't know how I knew it was an island, but I did. They were in a cave, like the Blue Grotto in Capri. You know how the waves break over the entrance at high tide?
Yes.
It was uncanny. I could hear people singing somewhere, and a drum, like a heart beating. I suppose it was my own heart.
It's strange you should dream of an island.
Well, what's the use of having a brother called Chandu the Magician if he can't interpret dreams? What do you think all that meant?
It's curious you should have dreamed of an island just as I'm leaving for one.
Your what?
I knew you didn't hear what I said. Tomorrow I have to go to a little Mediterranean island. 2 American consuls have disappeared, one after the other.
Oh, Frank.
The last one was Neil Christie. His wife is still on the island. She refuses to believe her husband won't turn up.
The temple under the sea, he said.
Now, Dodge.
Oh, I'm sorry, Frank. I can't get that dream out of my mind. Ooh, what a man.
You're unusually sensitive to such things. I've told you that before.
My dream?
Yes.
You know, I almost wish I could go with you and see that island for myself. Wouldn't it be strange if it were the one I saw? Oh, but that's impossible.
Well, you can go with me if you like. Consul's house is empty now. Mrs. Christie moved out.
Are you sure we wouldn't be in your way?
Not at all.
Well, look, don't say anything to Betty and Bob about why I want to go. I'd never hear the last of it. Imagine my rushing off like this because of a dream.
island is like something out of the Middle Ages.
Yeah, Mom, can't you just see the Crusaders on the cliffs pouring hot lead down on the Saracens?
Bob, you ghoul.
Well, that's what they used to do, Bats. Well,
this town's a lot older than that, though. There was a great port here in the days of the Phoenicians, centuries before Christ.
Oh, this is the house, sir.
Is this where Mrs. Christie's living now?
Yes, sir.
All right. I'll get the keys to the consul's house and be right out, Dot.
Uncle Frank, ask her who we see about renting one of those little boats we saw down in the cove. I am here in the garden.
Mrs. Christie?
Yes?
I'm Frank Chandler. I understand you have the keys to the American consul's house.
You cannot be appointed to take Neil's place. He will come back.
I hope so. I came here to find out what happened to your husband, if I can. This letter will tell you who I am.
They have told you I refuse to go away.
I can understand that. Perhaps you'd better tell me now what you know of your husband's disappearance. Then I won't need to bother you again.
It is that house. It is Yasaki.
Yasaki? Forbidden. Mrs. Christie, are you Arabic?
I come from Lebanon, Mr. Chandler. I met my husband in Beirut when he was the vice consul there.
Oh, yes. Why do you say that house is forbidden?
The consul who was here before my husband died of the curse.
How do you know?
The servants have told me. Mr. Chandler, I will tell you about Neil. We had invited guests for dinner that evening. He was dressing. I was in the garden. When the guests arrived, Neil was not in the house. His evening clothes were laid out. Nothing was missing, even the shoes.
You didn't find a note? Didn't the servants hear anything?
Neil did not leave me willingly. The unseen eyes were watching. Always they watched. When I turned away for one moment, Neil was taken.
I see. Now, if you'll let me have the key.
You must write a letter to your government. You must tell them to find another house for their consul. No one can live in that house.
I don't wonder you're upset. But if you'll get me the keys...
I have them here in my handbag. Mr. Chandler, do not look at me. Pretend that we speak of something else.
Yes. Yes, that is a very interesting old church across the street. What is it, Mrs. Christie?
It is true what I said about the unseen eyes watching. There is death in that house. And if you should find the...
Yes?
I have told you the truth. The house is accursed. No one can stay there and leave.
I see. Well, good afternoon, Mrs. Christie. If I need any more information, I'll drop in again.
What were you saying to him, Zuala?
He came for the keys, Delagi. I told him exactly what you said.
You whispered something I could not hear.
Why should I do that? I knew you would be listening.
For your sake, it is to be hoped you are speaking the truth.
Mr. Chandler is here for only a few days to make a report to the American government. Wait until he has gone away.
And while I am waiting, he will find them.
It is impossible. If you cannot find so much as the drawing after 2 years, how can a stranger find the chest itself?
I tell you, they must not live in the house.
But I tell
you... The man Chandler insists. He will find his family too. Is missing.
Delagi.
And there will once more be rumors of the temple under the sea.
You know what I think, Bob?
No, what?
I bet Uncle Frank thinks Mr. Christie's dead. I'm buried here somewhere.
In the house? They'd have to have a heck of a time doing it. Why, the walls must be 6 feet thick.
All right. But Uncle Frank keeps going around tapping with that hammer.
Sure, but I asked him what he was looking for, and he said he didn't know.
Oh.
Now, Betts, don't be so jittery. It's just somebody at the door.
Oh.
Good afternoon. My name is Delagi.
Well, how do you do? Won't you come in?
Thank you. Is Mr. Chandler in?
Yes, yes, he's here. Sit down.
I'll call him, Bob. Uncle Frank says someone to see you. Mr. Delagi.
Oh, thank you, Betty. Certainly not very presentable. Well, good afternoon. I've been going through the old consular files. A dusty job.
Oh. I call, as you would say, socially. I am an idle man. Here on this island for my health.
I see. Bob, tell your mother we have a caller, will you?
Oh, sure, Uncle Frank. She's in her room. I'll get her.
How long have you lived here, Mr. Delagi?
2 years. You will forgive me if I say you and your mother must be remarkable women.
Why?
Have you had no unpleasant experiences in this house?
I know. We think it's fascinating.
Well, it's very nice to have someone call... Oh!
Dot, what's the matter?
Nothing.
Come on, sit down here.
Oh, I must have been out in the sun too long.
Well, I'll get you some water.
Your sister is ill, Mr. Chandler.
I will call again at another time.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
You see now, Mr. Chandler, it has begun.
Mother, you look awful. Oh, tell me what to do.
I hope you will be feeling better quite soon, madame.
Here, Mom, drink this.
Oh, thank you. Frank, he's the man I saw in my dream, in the cave.
I thought he must be, the way you looked at him.
Yes, but it was only a dream. How could I dream of a man I'd never seen?
It has been known to happen.
Mother, what are you talking about?
What? Oh, dear, I wasn't going to say anything to you and Bob.
Huh?
Oh, please don't ask me about it.
Well, okay. At least you don't look so kind of green now.
I felt green. Who is he, Frank?
His name is DeLaggy. And I swear he's the man Mrs. Christie's so afraid of.
Afraid of?
She tried to tell me that first day. DeLaggy must have been right there in the garden somewhere. She said, if you should find the... And then she stopped.
Is that why you've been tapping the walls like a Death Valley prospector?
Yes, that's it, Bob. There's something hidden in this house, and Mrs. Christie knows about it. I'm going to look around that cellar once more.
Oh, well, I'll come too.
Not me. What if it turns out to be a body?
A body? Oh, darling, it can't be.
Dot, are you sure those people in your dream weren't in a cellar?
Oh, yes, it was a cave filled with uncanny blue light. I can see it now.
Mom, for Pete's sakes. Oh, aren't you coming, Bets?
Not a chance.
I wish you would, Dot.
Well, all right.
I'll need a flashlight.
Oh. Oh, here it is with the hammer. You want that, too?
Yes, Mom.
Well, what a crazy place to put the cellar stairs. Right off the living room.
May not have been the living room originally. In fact, the whole house might have been something else.
Like what?
Oh, I don't know. Now, let's see. Where did I stop when I was down here the last time? Now, give me the hammer, Bob.
Here you are.
Hold the light in the corner.
Here.
Huh. Listen to that.
Yes, it sounds hollow.
Yeah, but it can't be. The edges of that stone fit as tight as all the rest.
Maybe. Oh, there's a niche behind it. Shine the light in there, Bob.
What is that?
Why, it's just an old piece of paper.
I can just get it out in one piece. Yeah. That's it. Well, I unfold it.
All right.
Hold the light still, Bob.
Yeah.
Why, it's a drawing.
A map. Those wavy lines must represent the ocean. That figure's Neptune.
Yes, it's almost like the plan of a building. See, there's a room and a long hallway and...
That can't be right, Mom. Or else this thing isn't drawn to scale.
It means the whole thing is underwater.
Huh?
Underwater. The temple under the sea.
Look out, Dot.
Oh, now you've done it. It fell apart.
Oh, I wish we'd never found it.
I had to find it.
But can't you imagine how it feels to have that dream coming true? Everything, one after the other. Everything I saw that night. I'm going back upstairs.
We'll all go. And I'm going down to see the British Commissioner.
The British Commissioner? Well, how would he know about the map?
I think he'll know something about DeLaggy.
Oh. Well, look, Betty and I'll walk part way with you. We're going out in one of those little sailboats, you know.
Yes. But, Dot, you stay here, will you?
Well, of course. Where would I go?
I mean, I'm going to bring Mrs. Christie back with me. This time she'll have to tell me what she's afraid of in this house. And I want you here with me when she does.
You think I'll recognize her voice?
Yes, I do.
Well, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to know anything more about this dreadful place. Something terrible's going to happen here. I know it is.
In a moment, we'll raise the curtain on the second act of Chandu, the Magician. People usually write pretty fascinating things in their diaries, but the most interesting little black book of all belongs to Gregory Hood, and it isn't exactly a personal diary, it's a case book. And the case book of Gregory Hood contains many of the most fascinating mysteries you've ever heard. You see, Gregory Hood is a detective. He doesn't believe in the rough-tough methods many other excellent detectives use. Gregory Hood uses the smooth, suave approach. In fact, you might say he has almost a clinical interest in his work. For the thing that interests him in a crime is the unorthodox method by which it's done. So Hood carries on his work with the calm detachment of a scientist. His colleague in crime detection is a character known as Sanderson Tyler. So you'll enjoy the methodical, scientific way Gregory Hood goes about solving his crime. So don't miss the exciting adventures from the casebook of Gregory Hood on the air every Sunday afternoon over most of these same ABC stations. And now... back to our story of intrigue and magic. the small Mediterranean island of Ruad, its limestone cliffs rising from the blue sea. A gray stone house, old when the Crusaders sailed into the harbor. It is late afternoon. Chandu, the magician.
It's 5 o'clock. Where are Betty and Bob all this time? Oh, I wonder.
Oh. Is your brother here now, Mrs. Regent?
No.
That is unfortunate. I had hoped he could tell you.
Tell me what, Mr. DeLaggy?
Just DeLaggy, if you please. It has been my name through the ages.
What is it you have to tell me?
I was standing on the cliff a few moments ago. I saw your son and daughter pull a small boat up on the rocks below.
Yes?
You see, there is a cave which can be entered only when the tide is low. If they do not turn back at once, they will drown in the rising water.
I know.
I beg your pardon.
How do I get there? Is there a path down the cliff?
The cave can only be approached by sea. The tide is turning now, madame.
Oh, why didn't you do something? Where can we get a boat?
I have one, if you...
Well, then hurry! We may be too late!
You will have plenty of time, madame, in the temple under the sea.
Mr. Hunter, I suppose you know that all American consuls keep files on people who have any sort of business with them.
Oh, yes, it's customary.
Well, DeLaggy told me he'd only been on the island for 2 years. But it seems he was here once or twice before that.
I think that's true. I confess I don't know quite what to do about him, Mr. Chandler.
Why?
Well, a man who believes he's the reincarnation of an ancient Phoenician priest.
What's that?
Oh, yes, and there have been repeated rumors of a cult he's organized on the island, worshippers of a pagan god.
Neptune, of course.
It would be an obvious choice, I suppose.
Then there is such a thing as the temple under the sea.
By Jove, Christie was thorough.
No, I didn't get that from the consular files, Mr. Hunter. Tell me, what do you know about this temple under the sea?
It's a sort of recurrent myth. At the base of the cliffs, quite near that house of yours, there are curious grooves in the rock just under the water. The story is that they were made by chariot wheels.
The chariot of the temple priest.
Dragging the victims to the sacrifice. The so-called wheel marks enter a sort of tunnel worn by the water, presumably. It's underwater except at low tide, but one can go in then. I've been inside myself. Of course, it's nothing like a temple.
Then what about the singing?
You've heard of that, too. It can only be the wind in the rocks. I suppose Mrs. Christie told you all this.
No.
Well, DeLaggy and the Christies were great friends for a time. I don't like to repeat gossip, but in a small place like this, one hears everything.
Mr. Hunter, two American consuls have disappeared on this island. I've come here to find out what happened. What have you heard?
Well, it was said that DeLaggy had persuaded Mrs. Christie to join his little group of idol worshippers. And Christie threw him out of the house.
So that was it.
You believe DeLaggy was responsible for Mr. Christie's disappearance?
I wouldn't be surprised.
You know that house of yours is supposed to have been built over the site of an ancient pagan temple.
Is it indeed?
Yes, but certainly not a temple under the sea.
Well, thanks very much, Mr. Hunter. You may not believe that temple exists, but I do. And when I find it, I'll know what happened to Neil Christie.
Can never land there, DeLaggy.
There's a narrow channel here, Mrs. Regent.
Yes, but Bob and Betty aren't here.
Their boat must have drifted away.
Do you really think they're inside that cave?
I know they are, madame. Step quickly to the flat rock. I'm afraid your clothes will be wet.
I don't care about that.
I would go and bring them myself, but you could not control the boat.
No, I'll get them. Hold the boat still.
One moment. Now jump.
Oh.
Water is rising, madame.
Well, I'll be back with the children in a minute.
You need not hurry now.
DeLaggy, come back. You can't leave us here. We'll all be drowned.
Your brother should have given me the jewels.
Jewels?
Goodbye, madame.
No, DeLaggy, come back. DeLaggy!
DeLaggy!
mind, Mrs. Christine.
I am afraid of this house.
Now, I want you to tell me and my sister just why...
Listen, Mr. Chandler, listen to them. The singers of the temple under the sea.
How could we possibly hear them up here?
Someone has opened the way.
It must be the stone block I moved in the cellars.
Yes, the sound would come up from the sea.
Wait a minute. Dorothy! Dorothy! I wonder who she is. Dorothy!
Would your sister dare to walk down the hidden stairs?
No, she wouldn't go down to the cellar. She was terrified.
There is a stairway built inside the wall. Come, I will show you. Here.
So that's how DeLugge saw everything that went on in this house. Where did these stairs go?
I do not know. They are said to have been built in the days of the Crusaders. A great English lord hid a chest of jewels. Oh, I should not have told you. I am afraid.
You stay here.
If DeLugge is there, do not speak of me.
Dorothy is down here in the cellars. I know she is. Mrs. Christie, there's a heavy door here. How can I get it open?
Not even DeLugge knows how to open the door. He has tried many times.
No place for a key, no bolt. Hinges on the other side. Still, Dorothy's down there somewhere. I know she is. If ever I needed the things I learned in India, it's now. By the power of the 3x3, the secret of this ancient house is mine. The door must open now. Blue light, the temple. Dorothy!
Oh, Frank, Frank, you're too late. Betty and Bob were drowned.
Drowned? What are you talking about?
DeLugge left me at the entrance of the cave. The tide was rising. Betty and Bob were in there and I couldn't find them.
Well, they're all right.
No, Frank.
I just met them coming up from the harbor.
Oh.
Well, you knew they'd been out sailing.
Yes, but DeLugge said they were in there and I tried to find them.
You mean to say that DeLugge left you in that cave with the tide coming in?
Yes, he said
he meant to kill you.
Yes, I know he did. The cave was filling with water. I kept looking for the children.
It's a miracle you weren't drowned.
Well, I suddenly saw a flight of stairs. I ran up here. As soon as I got in, I recognized it from my dream. Oh, that singing, it's driving me mad.
I don't wonder. Where are they?
I don't know. Who's that?
Logging.
Voices of the temple! Be silent! Look at me, woman. You have found them.
That's what he said in my dream, Frank.
You cannot lie to me with the chest of jewels before your eyes as I knew it. Rubies. Emeralds, a king's ransom.
That may be just what they were.
Yes, but where did they come from? The chest wasn't there before.
Pearls, diamonds.
It was hidden under the bottom step. You see, when I opened the door, the whole step slid back. Those medieval architects knew all sorts of tricks like this.
Jewels are mine. Since the days of ancient Phoenicia, I, a priest of the temple, have worn them.
Oh, undoubtedly. And you just found out about them a couple of years ago in Europe.
You meddling fool.
Oh, yes, DeLugge. I've read the file Neil Christie kept on you.
Christie? He died in a temple like the other one.
And your little crowd of jewel thieves have been financing you here all this time, hoping you'd find this chest.
Christie did not know this.
The British commissioner will know it in an hour.
You will not live to tell him. You and the women will die here.
Get out of the way, Dot.
Frank, look out!
The sword of the temple priest!
Not this time, DeLugge. Oh.
American swine.
Get up.
Frank, he's not moving. You've killed him.
Oh, no such luck. He's just knocked out. Come on, Dot.
You're not going to leave him here like this. Can't we tie him up?
No, he can't get out of the tunnel until the tide turns. Now see that he doesn't get out through the house. The commissioner will send for him.
Heaven only knows what's in the other rooms down there.
Whatever it is, it can wait until tomorrow. We have to break the news to Mrs. Christie that her husband's dead.
Oh, dear, what a dreadful thing. Frank, how could I have dreamed all that? DeLugge knew about it. He said so.
Well, he said he was the reincarnation of a Phoenician priest, too. The racket was working very well until Christie began to suspect DeLugge's European contacts.
Yes, but how could I have seen DeLugge in a dream?
Well, nobody knows what a dream is, Don. Message? Warning? Or just a dream. And how many men have sisters who dream such useful things?
In just a moment, we'll bring you a glimpse of next week's story. Here's a reminder to you local businessmen. Just as you enjoy radio, so your neighbors and friends are regular listeners to programs of this ABC station. Why not use the radio program you're now hearing as a way to promote sales and goodwill for your business or product? You'll be surprised to know how reasonably and effectively you can sponsor Chandu the Magician in this, your own locality. Just call on the manager of this ABC station. He'll be glad to give you all the details about Chandu the Magician. And here's a reminder for all you mystery fans. Tomorrow night, the amazing Mr. Malone matches wits with any evil character unlucky enough to cross his path. Yes, you can be sure every case John J. Malone tackles is packed with action and suspense. Gene Raymond plays the part of our intrepid sleuth. So don't forget, tomorrow night is time for The Amazing Mr. Malone over most of these same ABC stations. And now for next week's story. Next week, Istanbul, a dark lady, beautiful and deadly, a stolen secret, and death on the Golden Horn. We invite you to listen next week for mystery, romance, magic. Chandu, the Magician. This is ABC, the American Broadcasting Company.
Hello there. This is CBS Radio Mystery Theater's Gordon Gould. You are listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
I'm Big John, and that's Steve. We welcome you back to The Glowing Dial, episode pod 77, where we celebrate Labor Day and sing, whoa, ho, ho, it's magic. Never believe it's not so. We just heard an episode of Chandu the Magician. That was Island of the Disappearing Men from Saturday, November 26, 1949, originally over ABC. And we have some more magical programs to bring you, but we have the next installment of Celebrity Birthdays for you right now. And you're Steve with those.
Yes, the next set starts off with August 29th, 1882, Richard LeGrand. He was born in the Mount Tabor section near Portland. He was an actor. He played Richard Q. Peavy on The Great Gildersleeve and Oli on Fibber McGee and Molly. August the 30th, 1908, Fred McMurray from Kankakee, Illinois, actor. He was George Harvey in Bright Star. He was also on Lux Radio Theater, and he was the more famous father on My Three Sons on TV. Robbie, Chip, and yes. Larry Elliott was born August 31st, 1900. He's our next person. He was born in Washington, D.C., and he was an announcer on Texaco Star Theater, American Melody Hour, and Barry Cameron. Then now moving on to September 1st, 1900, Don Wilson from Lincoln, Nebraska. He was the announcer on the Jack Benny program and also did the Good News of 1941. And September 2nd, 1896, Amanda Randolph, born in Louisville, Kentucky, actress. Mama from Amos and Andy, and Oriole from Beulah.
Okay, that's it.
That's the birthdays for the set.
We have one more set of birthdays, and then we're going to tell you how you can find out who you share your birthday with, thanks to our good friend Ron Sales. And that information in just a little while. Right now, we have another magical program to bring you, and that's going to be the first chapter in The Magic Island. This is one that ran quite a while. And this is Chapter 1, Jerry Hull's Proposal, also known as Jerry Hull's Mysterious Shortwave Clue. It's from Monday, August 12, 1935, originally over KNX Los Angeles and in syndication. And it stars Will H. Reynolds, Tommy Carr, and Sally Crichton. Perry Crandall is announcing. And that's all the information cast-wise that I have there. But Steve has some information he's going to impart to us about Magic Island.
What would you do if your child was lost? How long would you search in order to have your child back in your arms one more time? Magic Island tells the story of a mother, Patricia Gregory, and her search for her long-lost daughter, Joan Gregory. When Joan was 1 year old, the Gregory yacht was shipwrecked near the 30th parallel south. Lashed to a lifeboat, Joan was presumed lost by all but Patricia. 14 years after her rescue, Patricia still has not given up hope. In the opening episode, she receives a tip about a white girl living on a mysterious island populated by scientifically advanced people in the Pacific. With the help of a very handsome reward and the persistence of Jerry Hall, a young man who has been very interested in Mrs. Gregory's story ever since he learned to read, she sets off on an adventure to find her daughter. In reality, Joan has survived the living on man-made magic island that is so secretive it can submerge under the water in order to evade exposure. After the reunion of mother and daughter, the program dramatized their subsequent adventures on the island. The producer and writer was Perry Crandall, who was also the program's announcer. The serial ran for a total of 130 episodes between 1935 and 1938. It's magic. Frosted Lucky Charms.
Never believe it's not so.
Oh, it's magic.
It's tragic, you know. Never believe it's not so. Be glad we're not singing it, folks. All right, Steve, thank you for that information, and...
You're welcome.
Since we have so much to bring you here in this episode, let's just get this one going, too. We're tuning back to Chapter 1 here for this.
I have to reach in back of the McGee machine and flip some switches over here.
All right, folks, close your eyes and remember Magic Island. This is Chapter 1, Jerry Hall's Proposal, otherwise known as Jerry Hall's Mysterious Shortwave Clue. From Monday, August 12, 1935, originally over KNX Los Angeles and in syndication.
A wealthy and beautiful California woman, Mrs. Patricia Gregory, has spent 14 years searching the world over for her little daughter, Joan Gregory. 14 years ago, Mrs. Gregory, her husband and baby daughter, were shipwrecked in the South Pacific. Everyone on board was believed lost except Mrs. Gregory, but she has always felt that her little girl was also saved. This belief has caused Mrs. Gregory to offer a large reward for news of any young white girl found in the South Sea Islands who might prove to be her daughter. 14 years she has waited in vain, but now... The story begins in Los Angeles. It is just 12 o'clock midnight. A police radio car is cruising near Mrs. Gregory's home.
Car 67, at Western and Slauson, a fight. Car 67, at the service station, Western and Slauson, a fight. Car 14.
That's us.
Let's hear it then.
Calling car 14. Car 14. In North Chester Place, near the Adams Street entrance. Investigator Powell, North Chester Place near Adams. That is all.
Cut him off. We'll have a look around.
We're right in that block now.
Yeah. Slow down. This ought to be it.
I thought I saw somebody on that lawn there. That's a Gregory place, isn't it?
Yeah. There is something moving there. He's up the driveway, right behind him. Where are you going, buddy?
Who wants to know?
Hold it right there and I'll show you. Hold it there, kid. I want to talk to you.
Hey, why don't you take that flashlight out of my eye so I can see who you are?
It's a lot more important that I see who you are. What are you doing here this time of night?
Well, suppose you tell me what you're doing here, and then maybe I'll tell... Oh, golly, Whiskers. I didn't see your uniform at first. The cops, huh?
Right, the cops. Now can you remember what you're doing in this driveway?
Well, I might live here.
Ah, you might, but you don't. We got a call on you as a prowler.
A prowler? I'm looking for a lady's house. That's not prowling, is it?
Well, depends on whether the lady wants you to be looking for her. This is Mrs. Gregory's house.
Honest? She's the one I'm looking for. Much obliged. I'll go and see her.
Hey, not so fast, buddy, not so fast. Do you know Mrs. Gregory?
No. But I've got some news for her. I heard about her little girl being lost in the South Seas on a magic island.
Oh,
and I...
So, her little girl's lost on a magic island, eh? And her mama don't know it, but you're going to tell her. Well, I'm Santa Claus, and I'm taking you to the North Pole with me. Come on.
Hey, let go of my arm.
Oh, you're
let
going go. To the station house. Come on.
No, I'm not. Help! Help! Oh, Mrs. Gregory!
Will you shut
hey, somebody
up?
Somebody help! Hey! Hey there, you!
Hey, now you'll walk him up in the Gregory house.
I hope I woke up the whole
coming.
Block.
Take it easy, son. Now take it easy.
Here, this is no place to stage a fight.
Oh, well, we picked this kid up in your driveway on a prowler car.
I'm not a prowler, honest. I've got to see Mrs. Gregory right away.
Well, it isn't so easy to see Mrs. Gregory at midnight. What's your business here?
The kid's having a pipe dream about Mrs. Gregory's little girl floating around Australia on a magic island. I'll see that he don't bother you anymore. Come on, son.
Wait a minute. Hold it, officer. Did you say Mrs. Gregory's little girl?
You bet he did. But nobody's going to get a chance to laugh at me again. I'll tell my story to Mrs. Gregory, or not at all.
All right, officer. I'll be responsible for this boy. And if he's not what he represents himself to be, I'll send for you again. My name's Bradford. I'm in charge of...
Oh, that's all right, sir. I know you, Captain Bradford. Call us if you want anything else. And let us know how the kid's magic island comes out.
I'm sure glad you came out, sir. He was going to take me to jail.
Well, if your story doesn't sound just right, you'll still get a chance to go. Come on up the house now. We'll meet Miss Gregory.
I know she'll want to hear my story, but I kind of hate to get her up at this time of night.
Never mind that. Miss Gregory and I were just going out. You go open the door there and go right in. I'll follow you. Go on in, kid.
But you ought to go in first.
I'll be the judge of what I ought to do. Go on in. Now, straight down the hall to that lighted arch.
What's going on, Tex? I thought I heard... Oh.
Are you Mrs. Gregory?
Yes, I'm Patricia Gregory.
Let's go in and sit down, Pat. I'm anxious to get a good look at this young fellow.
Say, Mrs. Gregory, your butler is mighty suspicious of me.
Butler?
I'm sorry, Tex, but you should see your face.
Butler. What makes you think I'm the butler?
Well, heck... Nobody but a butler could act as suspicious of anybody as you do.
You're wrong, young man. Captain Bradford is in charge of my affairs. Manager of my estate, master of my yacht, pilot of my planes, and... But hadn't you better introduce yourself?
Yes, we'll ask a few questions now, son. You sit over there. Keep your hands in sight. Patricia, you stay near me.
Don't be absurd, Tex. What danger could there be? He's only a boy.
Yes, and Billy the Kid was only a boy when he had to put extra long handles on his guns to hold the notches.
Say, I've had about enough of this. I've got something to tell Mrs. Gregory. Do I get to tell her or don't I?
Of course you do. Keep quiet, Tex, and let the boy talk.
Thanks, Mrs. Gregory. Well, my name is Jerry. Jerry Hall. This afternoon, I picked up a radio message on my short wave set on a band I'd never heard anything on before. Somebody was talking in funny broken English... and said that an old sailor was very sick in a hospital, somewhere near Honolulu. I guess he didn't say.
There it is again, the same thing.
Wait, Tex. Go on, Jerry.
Well, I guess this old sailor was so sick, he didn't know what happened to him. He was raving about how he'd escaped from a magic island in the South Seas, and about a beautiful little white girl that was living there with some strange people. Well, I read all about your little girl being lost in the shipwreck when she was a baby, and I thought that, well, that is... Gosh, I guess it sounds kind of foolish when I try to tell it.
No, it doesn't, Jerry. It isn't foolish at all. And Captain Bradford and I are leaving tonight, within half an hour, sailing on my yacht. And we're going to find out all about that old sailor and his story.
Well, I've been reading all about your little girl ever since I could read. Is it true that you were shipwrecked in the South Seas, just like the stories say?
Yes, Jerry, it's all true. We were wrecked in the South Pacific when my little girl, Joan, was only a year old. Her father was lost, and of course, everyone else thinks my baby was also, but somehow I've never quite given up hope that someday I'd find her.
And we've chased all over the world to see girls that people show to us to try and get some of the money Mrs. Gregory offered, but they never are the right one.
Well, how could you tell your little girl? I mean, if it really was her.
Joan had a tiny birthmark, a little star-shaped scar on the back of her neck.
Joan. Gee, that's a pretty name. Joan, I'll bet you'd be pretty, too. Maybe almost as pretty as you are, Mrs. Gregory.
Thank you. There you are, Tex. Jerry's a bright boy.
Yes, his eyesight's all right. I'll say that. We've got to go. You see, kid, we heard the same thing on the short wave that you did. And we're sailing just as soon as we can get to the harbor.
Boy, that's slick. Will you take me with you?
Will we do what?
Take me along, will you? Oh, please.
Why, Jerry, we couldn't do that. We hardly know you. And you're so young, you can't be out of high school yet.
Well, I know my dad would let me go. And I know a lot about boats and aeroplanes and radios and all that sort of stuff. And I'd work hard on the yacht and... Oh, golly whiskers, how about it?
Not a chance, out of the question.
I'm sorry, Jerry, but it just wouldn't do.
Beg your pardon, madam, but the car is at the door. Everything is quite ready. Baggage loaded.
Thank you, Johnson. We'll be out in a moment.
Very good, madam.
Now, Jerry, I'm afraid we'll have to say goodnight to you. It was sweet of you to come and tell us about your radio message. Won't you let me give
you... Oh, no, thanks, Mrs. Gregory. It was fun for me. You see, I've dreamed about finding your... Oh, well. Good night. I hope you have a lot of luck.
Thanks,
good night,
Jerry.
Son.
Good night.
Oh, say, I was just thinking... If you could only let me go, I'd telephone my dad. He'd let me go when I tell him how nice you are, Mrs. Gregory.
Oh, Jerry, you're nice about this, and I would like to take you, but it wouldn't do, would it, Tex?
Sorry, kid, but it just isn't in the cards.
Boy, I'd sure like to see that magic island. The broadcast said there was something mysterious about it. How ships tried to sail up to it and couldn't, and that it was big but invisible. He gave the exact position. It might be true.
Afraid not, Jerry. We've sailed through there on two steamer lanes. There isn't an island the size of a watermelon that isn't on the chart.
Well, I guess I'd better go now.
I'll see you to the door.
Are you afraid I'm going to take something?
No, but I'm going to take something. Something to remember you by. Open the door. Go ahead. Open it.
Gee whiz! That flashlight nearly blinded me.
Sorry, but we like to take pictures of the people who come to see us at midnight, and we like to know when they open our door, too.
But when I came in, I opened the door myself, and nothing happened.
And I had the flashlight shut off. Now go on, kid, get out.
I'm sorry I bothered you, sir. Good night.
Fix, why were you so rough about sending him out?
I just got an idea. That boy's smart. He could have broadcast that message himself just to get a trip to the islands with us.
I suppose so, but... I do wish we could have taken him.
Well, it might have been wise at that. And I could have kept an eye on him till we ran the story down.
Oh, well, forget it. Hurry, Tex. Johnson's waiting in the car, and Jameson will lock up until we return. To the harbor, Johnson.
And step on it.
Johnson. Oh, Johnson.
Yes, madam.
We're awfully crowded back here. Couldn't you find room up front for this roll of steamer rugs?
I tried to put the roll up here, but he wouldn't have it.
Who wouldn't have what?
The young gentleman inside the rug, sir.
Huh? Say, Pat, there is somebody inside this roll.
And I can guess who it is.
I didn't think you'd find me till we got to the boat. And then maybe you'd take me with you.
I ought to wring your neck.
Now, Tex.
Oh, I know, Patricia, but...
Gee, Mrs. Gregory... That's an awful pretty name, Patricia. Oh, now look. I'm plenty big enough to go with you. And we'll telephone my dad from the dock, huh?
How about it, Tex?
Nope.
Oh, now, Tex.
No. You got her on Miss Gregory, all right, Jerry, but you can't do that to me.
Oh, no, sir. I wouldn't try to get around you. I can see that nobody could do that. You're too smart. But I would like to sail with you. I could learn a lot from a man as smart as you are, Captain Bradford.
All right, you win, kid.
Golly whiskers! To the harbor, Johnson, and step on it.
Hello there. This is CBS Mystery Theater's Corrine Orff. You're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
Welcome back to The Glowing Dial. This is episode pod 77, where Steve and myself celebrate Labor Day and sing, Whoa, ho, ho, it's magic. Never believe it's not so. We just heard Magic Island, Chapter 1, Jerry Hall's Proposal, otherwise known as Jerry Hall's Mysterious Shortwave Clue. That was from Monday, August 12th, 1935, over KNX Los Angeles and in syndication. Now we have a couple more magical programs to bring you, but before we do that, we have the last segment of Celebrity Birthdays. And no relation here that I know of, Otherwise, maybe I'd have some money, although I don't know how rich she was after all her radio work. September the 3rd, 1910, Grace Matthews from Toronto, Canada. She was an actor. She was Ruth Evans Wayne on Big Sister and one of several Margot Lanes on The Shadow. September 4, 1898, Charlie Cantor from Worcester, Massachusetts. He was an actor. He was Clifton Finnegan on Duffy's Tavern and Levy Solomon on AB's Irish Rose. September 5, 1907, saw the birth of Jimmy Wallington in Rochester, New York. He was an announcer for the Chase and Sanborn Hour, Texaco Town Star Theater, and the Alan Young Show. September 6, 1894, in Flint, Michigan, Billy Mills was born. He was a conductor for Fibber McGee and Molly, The Great Gildersleeve, and Amos and Andy. September 7th, 1927, one of the great voice actors of our time, Mr. Don Messick, was born in Buffalo, New York. He was an actor for Let George Do It, Horizons West, NBC University Theater, and, like I said, many voices for Hanna-Barbera cartoons, including the Flintstones.
He did Astro, I know.
That's all right, Roy. Re-ro-roo. Ralphaz. September 8, 1922, Mr. Sid Caesar, one of my favorites, from Yonkers, New York. He was a comedian for Voice of the Army, the Tex and Jinx Show, Your Show of Shows, and Caesar's Hour, those two on live TV. So they really did their due diligence there. And Carl Reiner was also with them, as was Imogene Coca. And some of the writers, I think, were Mel Brooks and Woody Allen, just to mention two. Neil Simon, I think, wrote some, too, for them. So a lot of writers got their start on...
Howard Morris was a regular on that show, too.
Yes, I remember the bit they did, the takeoff of This Is Your Life. They called it This Is Your Story. And Sid was the guy they picked out of the audience. And Howard Morris was Uncle Goofy. He wouldn't let go of Sid's leg through the whole thing, you know, just very, very silly stuff.
And Bill Hayes did music on the show. He was one of the singers before he did his Ballad of Davy Crockett.
Okay, yeah, yep.
Which was years later. And then he was on soap operas for years.
If you haven't seen any of Caesar's Hour or Your Show of Shows, there are some videos out there and some stuff probably on YouTube, too. So just take a look. It's early live TV. Fly by the seat of your pants performances, but some very funny stuff.
Very creative acts on there. I mean, things that were done for the first time on TV. So yeah, enjoy it.
Yeah, back when they thought some people still thought TV was a joke, and it was below you to work in radio or TV as opposed to Hollywood films. But many great Hollywood actors went to TV and radio and did some work and some fine work at that, and we're glad they did.
The only real true art is those who do on the stage. No recording devices. You must see it live.
Well, some would agree with that.
These are the people way back in the 1800s. They did not believe anything but live performances.
Well, there really wasn't anything but live performances in the 1800s.
That's the way to go.
And when the phonograph came into being, that was thought to be a joke by some, too. Others thought it was an amazing thing, that hearing the human voice reproduced. Wow.
We don't see any reproductions in real life. It's something that should be done behind your closed doors at home.
Is that an impression of anyone in particular, or just an amalgam?
Just a stuffy person.
An amalgam of stuffy people.
Stuffy person, right.
Stuffy people. Sounds like an old song or something. I don't know.
I had an old almanac I had back from 1947, and in it, they didn't have a lot of the movie actors and actresses in there, and that's because they believed in stage. They had a lot of stage actors and things, and some vaudeville performers and such, but, you know, as far as the people of the day in motion pictures, they didn't have very many of them, because that entertainment still was considered a little gauche in some people's eyes, you know, the people of true art.
Well, especially vaudeville and burlesque. That was considered probably the lowest of the low, but that is where some of our greatest comedians got their start.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Jack Benny, the Burns and Allen, Abbott and Costello. Even, I suppose, even to some degree, the Marx Brothers, because they were on stage, too. Some of their first films for Paramount were just filmed versions of plays they had done on the stage.
Yes. Well, that's where the nightclub came from. They'd have the acts come out and do their stuff on the stage, but they were, you know, a little off the beaten path there, rather than going to see a play with a, you know, an actress or an actor in it. That was considered supposed to be the entertainment. So,
well,
a little different way, you know, over the years, how entertainment has changed in the eyes right. of Americans. Yes.
Martin and Lewis and Rowan and Martin, not two different Martins there, got their start in the nightclub circuits.
Yes.
And that's where Lucy and Desi went to prove to CBS that I Love Lucy could be cast with Desi as her husband.
Mm.
They went and took an act on the road just to prove, and then out of their own pocket, they shot the pilot for the show.
Poor pilot.
Which essentially
it's magic.
it was My Favorite Husband for TV, although that series actually was on TV later on with a different cast.
Mm-hmm.
So
somehow I don't think you would have really enjoyed entertainment back when it was done live, John. You'd have to go see an opera singer.
I wouldn't go see opera, period. I can't stand it. I can't stand the shrillness of it.
That was considered the entertainment venue, so yeah. You'd be already automatically gauche.
No, I'd be in the Vaudeville Theater seeing Jack Benny or Abbott and Costello. And the people I knew were going to be something big, you know.
You know, that one woman that came to Lucy in that one episode, we don't want entertainers just for the sake of entertaining.
The Society Matrons
Society
League.
Society Matrons League. Yes, they liked opera and that sort of entertainment. They didn't like the other kind of performers. Gauche.
Oh, gauche.
Yes, those were the ones that, you know, the society pages.
Anybody that stuck up, I do not need to be associated with.
Right.
Who judges somebody by social standing or how much money they have, and that's crap. You judge somebody on character. And that's no joke. Anyway, moving on. We're done with the birthdays. We just finished that. So we have our next show, which is The Man of Magic. This is a bit of a rarity. I think it's a one-of-a-kind. Provided by our good friend Jerry Handigas. Thank you, Jerry. It's called Smiling Irish Eyes.
Oh, how wonderful.
Otherwise known as St. Patrick's Day Show. From Thursday, March 16th, 1944. Originally over Mutual. And it's with Felix Greenfield, a mind reader. Special guests are actress Wendy Berry and Congressman Emanuel Sella, John McKnight, and Walter Amy is announcing. The sponsor is Eichler's Beer. Now, we came up with some information on this rare show, and Steve's got that for us right now.
The Man of Magic. Very little is known about this series. What we do know has been gathered from the only known existing broadcast and from Jerry Handiga's vintage radio log for the show. Watch your thoughts. Here comes the Man of Magic. Yes, here he is, the Man of Magic. Radio's newest and most mystifying, most entertaining personality, the Man of Magic. Who knows what you think before you speak? The Man of Magic was Felix Greenfield, a public relations man connected over a period of 34 years with Warner Brothers. He was also a professional magician and mentalist. Greenfield performed astonishing feats while attired in street clothes and was remembered for his close-up magic in addition to his more sensational mentalism and bullet-catching routine. At different times, he was president of many magic organizations in the New York area, as well as the Magicians Guild. He was also a member of the London Magic Circle. Greenfield was involved in the fight against fraudulent activities in the occult world and was in the midst of writing a book about the life of Dr. Stanley Jacks, a well-known magician, when he died in 1974. The show was done for Mutual in the mid-1940s in front of a live audience. It was sponsored by Eichler's Beer. I never heard of that one. In the only known existing episode, he reads the mind of a special guest, actress Wendy Berry, as well as tells a listener at home what he's thinking about on his own telephone. This particular episode has a St. Patrick's Day theme.
Okay, and that's all we know, and the rest of what you will know about this program is going to be gained from the listening of it. And we're going to do that right now. So, Steve, if you can hit the fine-tuning on the McGee machine, since this is the only version of this program extant.
I have the AUX button here that is rarely used, and that one will be switched on as I do
that's
adjusting.
For tuning in programs featuring AUXes. Or AUX Smith. That's if Dr. Smith was turned into an AUX.
You know. Some folks who are clumsy AUXes is correct.
Yes.
Let's see if that brings it. I think I hear something.
Sure does. All right, folks, sit back. Close your eyes. Remember the man of magic. This is Smiling Irish Eyes, the St. Patrick's Day Show, from Thursday, March 16th, 1944, originally over Mutual.
It's even appetizing to think about the smooth, creamy-colored glass of Eichler's beer. But how much better it is to have Eichler's beer handy when you want it for yourself and your friends. So keep your refrigerator well supplied with Eichler's beer, New York's favorite for 82 years. Your grocer carries Eichler's. Enjoy a good, tangy glass of Eichler's at your favorite tavern.
Your thoughts. Here comes the man of magic.
Yes, here he is, the man of magic, radio's newest, most mystifying, most entertaining personality. The man of magic who knows what you think before you speak. And who tonight,
in a special St. Patrick's Day program, matches sleight of mind against the luck of the Irish,
reads the mind of our very special guest, the glamorous star of stage and screen, lovely Wendy Berry.
And tells some listener at home what he's thinking about on his own telephone.
So now watch your thoughts, for here he comes, Felix Greenfield, the man of magic.
Thank you, John McKnight, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Although tonight I really should begin our program with a top of the evening to you folks, for tonight we honor St. Patrick. Yes, all the participants for our experiment in sleight of mind will be of Irish extraction, and all our experiments will have a decided Irish flavor. Incidentally, before we begin tonight's program, may I say that we hope that the mental illusions which we create during the next half hour will amaze, mystify, and entertain you. However, in these experiments, we do not employ plants or confederates, nor do we claim psychic or supernatural powers. And all persons appearing in these experiments are willing volunteers, previously unknown to me, and selected at random from our studio audience by a prominent public figure who has come here tonight as our special guest for this express purpose, as well, of course, to check the authenticity of these experiments. Tonight's special guest is the Honorable Emanuel Seller, representative of the people to the Congress of the United States from the 10th Congressional District of the State of New York. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a pleasure to present Congressman Seller.
Good evening, Mr. Greenfield, ladies and gentlemen. I indeed feel a little out of place here tonight, Mr. Greenfield.
Is that so? Well, why is that, Congressman?
Well, you know, Seller, St. Patrick's Day.
I say, well, don't let that worry you. I'm sure that if all the volunteers you select for our experiments are Irish, well, everything will be all right. As a matter of fact, I understand that we have a great number of the sons and daughters of Erin here in our studio tonight. And I think this being St. Patrick's Day, we should favor them. Don't you think so, audience? Thank you. Well, Congressman, there you have your instructions. And now to get on with our first experiment, would you kindly ask for volunteers? Our studio audience prefers you to favor the Irish, so that ought to make your job much easier.
I'll do my best. When do we start?
Right now. For those of you in our studio audience who wish to participate in our first experiment, kindly raise their hands. We would like a gentleman, someone who's alone here tonight, and preferably one who would really like to celebrate St. Patrick's Day in a big way. All right, there are several hands. Congressman Sella, would you be good enough to select a participant for our first experiment?
I think I see a gentleman who looks as if he might be Irish out there, right on my left, in the third row, second seat from the aisle. Sir, will you please come up to the stage?
And now, ladies and gentlemen, while our first volunteer is stepping up on the stage, suppose we tell you about our first experiment.
Tonight, the man of magic experiments with smiling Irish eyes.
Yes, tonight, the gentleman of Irish extraction, just selected from our studio audience by Congressman Seller, will have a chance to celebrate St. Patrick's Day at the expense of the man of magic. He's going to have a chance to go to a famous nightclub with all charges paid and with a very lovely guest. Now, up here on our stage, we have a bulletin board on which are pasted cutouts of smiling Irish eyes. Now, these eyes are those of some very lovely gals, all of which are Irish, of course. Now, our gentleman friend here will have the opportunity of going nightclubbing with the lovely possessor of one of those pairs of eyes. However, he must choose his companion for the evening simply by selecting one pair of those eyes, and as the man of magic definitely has some ideas on the subject, he's going to try and mentally force the gentleman to pick one specific pair of eyes, all of which promises to be a lot of fun.
Nicely put, John McKnight. And now our volunteer is at the microphone. Well, you certainly look as if you're an Irishman. We have a little shamrock in the lapel there. And what is your name, sir?
Tom Downey.
Tom Downey. Mr. Downey, you're not married, or are you?
Yes, sir.
You are. Well, all right, we have a lot of fun for you tonight anyway. We've never had the pleasure of meeting before, Mr. Downey, is that correct?
That's right.
And we haven't prearranged anything in advance, is that true?
That's true.
Fine. All right, now before we begin our experiment, just one more question. I want to make sure that you're a real honest-to-goodness Irishman. Do you come from Ireland by any chance?
I do, yes.
You do?
Yes.
All right, will you kindly concentrate on the town in Ireland that you come from? Just try and mentally project to me the town, the name of that town. It's a county, as I receive it from you, and I would say it's County Kildare.
That's right.
County Is that right? Ireland. You say it much better than I do. What is the exact name of that?
County Kildare, Ireland.
County Kildare. All right, that's fine. And now, what is your occupation, sir?
A bartender.
You're a bartender. All right, good enough. Would you concentrate, please, on where you work? The name of the place that you work. It's a very famous place, noted for their beefsteaks. Could that be Beefsteak Charlie's?
That's right.
On 46th. Well, tonight, Mr. Downey, as you've heard, we're going to let you paint the town green, a real green in honor of St. Patrick's Day. How'd you like that?
Very well.
That's fine. Now, as John McKnight has explained, you're going to have the chance of celebrating with a very lovely companion up here on our stage. As you see, on this board over here, we have pasted cutouts of a number of a very alluring pairs of eyes belonging to some very lovely Colleen. Now, the owners of these eyes are very famous and gorgeous models. And just to prove that we're not fooling, I'm going to let you meet one of these lovely models right now. Bring her out. And here she is, ladies and gentlemen, the very, very lovely Colleen Clark, the beautiful Irish kind of a cover girl who has been made Miss Palladium Blonde of 1944. Incidentally, she's really Irish. Notice the Irish fingernail polish. Well, now, just to get you in the right mood, I'd like, here she is to say hello to you. Would you mind just saying hello to her?
Good evening, Mr. Downey.
That's fine. Now, tell me, how would you like to have Miss Clark accompany you on our trip around town tonight?
Why, I'd just love it.
I imagine you would. Well, now, maybe we can arrange it. You see, all you have to do is select Miss Clark's eyes out of this group that we have right here on our board. However, sir, so that you do not get too good a look at Miss Clark's eyes, I'm going to ask Walter Rennie to escort her out of the studio. And, I just thought of something. Now, if you're going to do the town with someone as attractive as Miss Clark, I think you ought to be dressed for the occasion. Now, backstage, we have a suit for that occasion, including a cutaway hat, a high hat, a shillelagh, and all the trimmings. So I think you ought to go backstage with John McKnight and get dressed up for the occasion, don't you?
Patty's night and everything goes.
All right, fine. All right. John McKnight is escorting this gentleman out, and he really is a grand sport, ladies and gentlemen. And they're going out of the door, and they're out of sight now. Fine. Well, all right, ladies and gentlemen, here is our little gag, and here is the fun. Now, everything that we've said tonight has been true. All these eyes which you see on our board here are those of famous models. And all of the possessors of these eyes are female. Also, they're all Irish. But there's one very pair of lovely eyes that are very appealing, and they belong to a model that models dog biscuits. It's a dog, but we didn't lie, it is an Irish setter. So it is Irish. Now, we kept our word. Now, we're going to bring the gentleman back in a little while. We're going to blindfold him. He won't know who he is. And remember now, it is an Irish setter. It's a beautiful dog, and let's have a lot of fun. Now, don't give it away, and whenever you're ready, you can bring him back. All right, sir? The gentlemen are calling our friend, and oh, you look wonderful, sir. Oh, you look marvelous. Yes, he's back on the stage, and he really looks wonderful. Now, sir, you're going to have a choice of all these pair of eyes. Incidentally, he has a shillelagh in his hand, and he's really doing it wonderfully. Now, sir, I'd like you to go, give you an opportunity to go nightclubbing with the owner of a pair of eyes that you select. Now, you'd be proud, I imagine, to walk down the aisle with a lovely model on your arm.
Why, I certainly would.
An Irish one? Would you have any objections in holding hands with this Irish model across the table?
Why, certainly not.
In a nightclub?
That's my
you'd enjoy
ambition.
It. All right, that's fine. All right. Now, by the way, what type of girl do you like? Do you like blondes, brunettes, redheads?
I like redheads.
Redheads?
Redheads.
Well, that's perfect because we have a redhead backstage. Lovely long red hair. Do you like long red hair?
I love them.
Oh, it's marvelous. And she also has beautiful, melting eyes. I'm sure you're going to have a good time. Well, now, here is our array of smiling Irish eyes. Now, I'd like you to look them over, sir, and kindly concentrate on the name of any pair of eyes there. Just concentrate on that, sir, and we're going to give you a slate and a piece of chalk, and I'd like you to write down the impression you receive. But do not write it down until I start to concentrate, because I'm going to try and mentally pick the one that I think you will have the most fun with tonight. All right, sir, would you take the chalk in your hand? I'm going to try to give it to you a letter at a time. Would you write the first letter that comes into your mind? Write the second letter. The third. The fourth. The fifth. And one more. All right, sir. Would you mind turning your slate to the audience and announcing what you've written on it?
Reggie.
Reggie. Ladies and gentlemen, I have written on my slate, Reggie. And that is the name of the Irish lass that I have selected for you tonight. Incidentally, you don't mind giving the Irish lass a nice big hug, do you?
Certainly not.
And a kiss, would that be appropriate?
That's fine, too.
All right, well, tell me, have you ever been on a blind date?
Not yet, no.
You haven't? Well, you're going to be on one right now, because we'd like to blindfold you. Do you mind if we do that?
No, that's perfectly all right.
Thank you. You're really a grand sport, and we appreciate it. And our announcer is now blindfolding the Irish gentleman. And he really looks very, very imposing here. Can he see? No, he can't. That's fine. Now, the reason we did that, sir, is we don't want to embarrass the Irish model that you're about to kiss. And so, John, would you bring out that Irish model? Just bring her right out on the stage. Oh, she is gorgeous. She is gorgeous. You can hear the audience. She has a nice red ribbon. I'm sorry, a green ribbon in her hair. She's fine. All right, would you mind just going right up next to our Irish gentleman, and would you like to give him a nice big kiss? I'd like you to hug him, sir. Would you hug him? She's wearing a fur coat. I hope you don't mind.
Why, that fur feels wonderful.
It's a fur coat. Well, all right, sir. I'd like to introduce you to whom you have met. Miss Nichols has brought over a very, very lovely model. It's an Irish setter from the Meador Kennels, and we've had a lot of fun with it. Now, sir, we're going to hold you to your promise now. You said that you would like to go to a nightclub, and we have made arrangements with Pat Harrington's nightclub, and you're going to have there and have a wonderful time. Now, you said you'd like to walk down Broadway with this model on your arm. That's all right with us, sir.
Definitely
and
not.
Also to hold hands. You don't mind holding hands across
Certainly
the table,
not.
Do you? I think you look very nice. Well, now, really, you've really been such a swell man that we're going to give you a treat. We're going to have Colleen Clark along as chaperone. You won't mind that, will you?
That's delicious.
No, she really is lovely, and thanks a lot. And good night and a happy St. Patrick's Day to you.
Thank you.
And now the Man of Magic special experiment with our very lovely and talented guest of honor, your movie favorite and mine.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is a genuine pleasure to present Miss Wendy Berry.
Good evening, Miss Barry, and as John McKnight has put it, it is a genuine pleasure to have you with us tonight.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here, Mr. Greenfield. Magic has always intrigued me, and what I've seen of your experiments in sleight of mind this evening, it's both baffled and fascinated me.
Well, thank you, Miss Barry. And by the way, I've read a great deal about the great work you're doing for the Red Cross.
Well, in Hollywood, I assist at the Red Cross Blood Bank.
I see. Well, your appearance here tonight on behalf of the Red Cross certainly shows what a wonderful job you're doing. Miss Barry, by the way, I understand that the Red Cross activities embrace over 101 different types of services. That is, including both the activities in behalf of the war effort and the usual civilian services. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. That's right, Mr.
Greenfield. I see. Well, now, suppose you concentrate on any one of those 101 Red Cross activities, and I'll try and mentally receive an impression from you of what specific activity you're thinking. Now, don't tell me out loud. Just concentrate it on any specific activity of the Red Cross. Why would you concentrate? The one that you think is most important in your mind. I get an impression that you're concentrating on men overseas, men missing in action. You're concentrating, I believe, on the fine work that the Red Cross is doing in locating missing boys.
Mr. Greenfield, you're wonderful.
Is that right?
Oh, boy.
Well, yes. Thank you.
I think it's one of the finest things that the Red Cross does, and it sort of helps knit America close together. I mean, our boys overseas and we at home.
I see. Well, that's fine. Incidentally, Miss Barry, for the benefit of our audience, would you mind establishing one fact? That is, we have prearranged absolutely nothing. Is that correct?
Well, that's a fact, Miss Greenfield.
All right, fine. All right, now, Miss Barry, would you tell us some of the things the Red Cross is doing for our boys on the fighting front?
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Red Cross War Fund Month. Does the significance of this month and this war fund impress you at all? It should. It means that in 1 month, your Red Cross must collect the funds which will finance its activities during the entire year to come. In this month, you have the opportunity of contributing to the saving of lives, the establishment of homes away from home for our men overseas, the raising of fighting heroes' morale all over the world. If your contribution is $5, it'll pay for the collection of 5 blood plasma transfusions. If your contribution is $50, you'll be providing 625 American prisoners of war with Red Cross first aid kits, which will meet their emergency health needs for a month. A $100 contribution will provide sufficient Red Cross recreation workers in hospitals overseas to cheer and comfort 7,000 sick and wounded men for a day. But the success of the 1944 Red Cross War Fund campaign depends primarily upon us individually, you and me. You see, it's our Red Cross. We must always remember that if we do our part and if we don't do our part, someone somewhere in his moment of extreme need will not have what he needs. It may be the difference between life and death. Maybe your son, your husband, your neighbor, or your friend. Let's not look at this campaign in terms of quotas and statistics or percentages. Let's think of the men on the front line whom our American Red Cross serves, and then let our generosity measure up to his needs. Thank you.
Well, Miss Barry, none of us should have to be told why we should give to the Red Cross War Fund. But in the event that there were any in our audience who did not know why they should, well, they certainly ought to know why after that stirring appeal of yours. In fact, what you have said struck home so hard that I believe that there are a number of our guests here in our studio audience tonight who want to give to the Red Cross War Fund. Will those of you here in our theater audience who want to give to the Red Cross War Fund please raise your hand? You see, Miss Barry, we have a lot of results thanks to you. That's really splendid. And now, I have an idea. Will those of you in our audience who have raised your hands and who want to contribute to the Red Cross War Fund kindly concentrate on the reason why you would like to give to the Red Cross Fund. Now, I know there are a great many reasons. I'm going to ask each one of you to concentrate on an important reason to you personally. I'm going to try to receive the thoughts of you in the audience and see if I can pick you out. All right? Would you concentrate on any reason, anything important? I get an impression of someone overseas, someone in an internment camp, someone in Germany. Is there anyone who is concentrating on that reason for giving to the Red Cross? Anybody? The gentleman, 1, 2, 3, 4, in the fifth row, all the way on the left-hand side, sir. Would you mind standing up? What is your name, sir?
John Russo.
Mr. Russo, we've never met before, is that correct?
No, sir.
And you had no knowledge that we were going to ask you any questions here tonight?
No, sir.
Thank you. Mr. Russo, is that statement that I made correct? Is there someone overseas in an internment
camp?
There is. There is. A friend of yours?
A buddy of mine.
A buddy. Would you concentrate on the gentleman's name? The first name, as I receive it, is Walter. And the second name, Y-E-S-S, I believe it's an I-A-N. Is that correct?
That's correct, sir.
Have you communicated with him lately?
Pardon?
Have you communicated with him lately?
Yes, I have.
You have. Well, that's fine. I imagine, sir, that you would be really like to help. Is there anything that you can think of that you'd like to do?
At the present time, I'd gladly contribute all the change I have in my pocket to that worthy cause.
Well, do you know how much change you have in your pocket?
No, offhand, I do not, sir.
All right, would you take it out? Incidentally, I'd appreciate if our announcer would turn away so that he cannot possibly see the amount of change in the gentleman's pocket. Would you look and count it, please? I get an impression you have 57 cents.
That's exact.
I received 2 quarters, a nickel, and 2 pennies. Is
that
right?
That's exact, sir.
Well, I'll make a deal with you, Mr. Russo. If you'll be kind enough to give that money to our announcer for the Red Cross, leave your name and address, I'll send you a war bond for your generosity.
Pardon me, sir.
Thank you very much.
Just a moment, sir. While you're on the subject, sir, I have a letter in my pocket, which I'm going to mail to my buddy.
I see. Well, I'm very, very glad that you are. Thank you very much.
And now, those of you at home, watch your thoughts.
The Man of Magic is about to read them on your own telephone. Yes, in just a moment, your telephone may ring, and it may be a call from the Man of Magic, who will try and mentally reveal your thoughts on your own telephone.
So watch your thoughts.
Here in our studio theater, our 300 guests have written down telephone numbers of friends at home listening to this program. Tonight, however, we have asked them all to pick Irish friends in honor of good old St. Patrick's Day.
These telephone numbers were collected in an ordinary paper box from which our guest, Congressman Emmanuel Seller, will now select the number to be called.
Congressman, would you be kind enough to pick any phone number out of this ordinary paper box?
I should be glad to, Mr. Greenfield.
All right, so anyone at all? Just make
I
a
have
point.
One.
You have, fine. Now, what I'd like you to do, sir, is to phone that party right here on our stage. I'd like you to, when you receive the party, tell them that you're at the Man of Magic show, that you are introduce yourself to them, and let them know exactly what we're going to do, and tell them would they please cooperate in an experiment. Incidentally, may I have that slip of paper? I'd like to find out the name of the person we're trying to call. We're trying to call a Mr. Jim Burke. Is there anyone in the audience who has written Jim Burke on a slip of paper? Anybody at all? There's a hand. The young lady down there, would you mind taking it? And, oh, evidently Irish, ladies and gentlemen. She's a very attractive young lady. Would you please rise? And she's wearing a nice green dress and a green bow in her hair. There's no need in asking you if you're Irish. What is your name?
Peggy Burke.
Peggy Burke. Miss Burke, I imagine this is a relative of yours?
That's right. He's my brother.
Your brother. And are you sure he'll be in tonight?
Positive.
Why is that?
Well, this afternoon he was out walking in that parade, and he's probably all wet, and he must be tired.
I see. Well, our congressman is trying to get him on the phone, and would you go ahead and dial, sir?
I shall.
And while we're getting him, I'd like to ask you something. You and I have never met before, is that correct?
That's right.
Hello?
And we've never had anything prearranged. You had no idea you were going to be called tonight?
No, sir.
Fine. And I'd like you to ask you to concentrate while we're waiting for the phone call on something about yourself. Would you concentrate, please, on where you were born, the city? The city, as I receive it, is Elizabeth, New Jersey. Is that correct?
That's right.
That is right.
this Ingersoll 26436? Who is this? Jimmy Burke.
Jimmy Burke.
Jimmy Burke, Mr. Greenfield.
Would you tell Mr. Burke that this is the Man of Magic program?
Mr. Burke, this is the Man of Magic program, and would you be pleased or would you be willing to cooperate
tell him in
the conduct
of
this
Patrick's
program?
Day.
We are celebrating St. Patrick's birthday today, and we hope that you might be able to participate in this program. Will you be glad? Would you be pleased to do so? He answered that he'd be glad to do so.
Fine. All right, would you ask him if he marched in the entire parade? He's there all afternoon.
The Man of Magic asked me to ask you in turn whether you marched in the parade this afternoon. He said he did.
Was it the entire parade?
Were you in the entire... Did you march in the entire parade?
What did he say?
He said that he did not participate in the entire parade, that he had to stop because he had tired feet.
Holy feet. Well, all right, will you ask him to concentrate on the street? Does he know the street that he stopped at?
Do you know the street at which you stopped? Were you willing to tell you?
Don't
you tell
ask
us?
Him for it. I'd like to get the
Wait
impression from him. Just ask him to concentrate on it.
Just concentrate on that street.
Is he concentrating?
He's concentrating.
I have written it down on the slate. Would you ask him what street he stopped at?
Would you tell us at what street you stopped?
What
he said he, he stopped at 48th Street.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have written 48th Street.
Ladies and gentlemen, you have been listening to the Man of Magic, radio's newest, most mystifying, most entertaining personality. Who knows what you think before you speak? A copyrighted feature of Sid Waters Associates.
Production by Norman H. Warrenbud.
Our guests tonight were Congressman Emanuel Seller of New York and the glamorous star of stage and screen, Wendy Berry.
Music was by Jerry Sears. This is Walter Rainey joining
John McKnight in extending an invitation to you to be our guests next Friday at 10:03. Until then,
watch your thoughts. Remember, the Man of Magic.
This is America's leading independent station.
Hi, this is Bob Hastings. Just telling you that you should be listening to Glowing Dial with Big John and Steve. Don't miss it. It's fun.
Welcome back to the Glowing Dial, folks. This is episode pod 77, where Steve and I are celebrating Labor Day in singing, Whoa, Ho, Ho, It's Magic.
77.
You know.
Sunset Strip. 77.
Can we 77?
Can you sing that without the plosives, please?
I will try.
That's when you do the P sound right into the mic there. I mean the letter P, not the other P sound. The other P sound would be a tinkly kind of thing.
You're peeing me off.
Yeah, someone's doing that to me right now, too, and it's not you. Again, enough said. All right. We just heard the Man of Magic. That was Smiling Irish Eyes, the St. Patrick's Day show, from Thursday, actually, March 16th, 1944, originally over Mutual. And that was a one-of-a-kind show, the only one known to exist. So we hope you enjoyed that, enjoyed the uniqueness of it. We have one more show to bring you to round out this magical episode of The Glowing Dial. But first, I just want to reiterate about The Glowing Dial Live. If all goes to plan as we're recording this, you may have already heard one of the latest episodes. We try to do one every third Sunday of the month from 4 to 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Now, you can talk with us via our chat room over at Mixlr.com or talk to us by phone. Give us a call and be on the show with us. Talk old-time radio with us. You can Skype us, too. And talk old-time radio with us that way as well. And have the opportunity to win some cool prizes. We do a trivia contest every episode. And the grand prize is a USB flash drive with about 15 or so old-time radio programs of a certain theme. Sometimes it'll be comedy, maybe sci-fi, or thrillers, or sitcoms. I don't know, something like that. And we have... one of our friends who has won most of these, although she has given up the prize a couple of times to others, just to be nice about it, so she wouldn't have a monopoly on it. And Makimba, you know who you are. And we also have an audio-only feed of the show, which is from our good friends at Mixlr.com. And we can also see us when we do the show on YouTube and Facebook video with our webcam here. So you can see what Steve and I and whoever else happens to sit in on the show, what we look like.
While ooh, who'd want to do that?
While we're
ooh.
Doing the show. And sometimes the little kitty, our little kitty, makes an appearance. At least she used to when she was smaller. She used to just come and jump up on my lap and you could see her on the camera, you know. Little black kitty with green eyes. And she's still a sweetheart, very well behaved, unlike the other cat, who we are having trouble with currently. He's hissing and biting, and I think we're just going to have to find a place for him, and that's not here.
Oh, give me a home where the cats do not roam, and make a mess of things in the house. Something like that.
Okay, I thought you were going to keep going with it. Okay.
Oh, no.
No, no.
Enough is enough.
Enough is enough. Wasn't that a disco hit?
Donna Summer.
Was that Donna?
Enough is enough is enough. I can't go on.
I thought it was somebody else.
Or no, enough is enough is enough.
Hmm.
No, Donna Summer.
Okay, well, yeah, it's hard to believe Donna's not with us anymore.
And it's summer, I know.
Some others passed away quite young, too. Patsy Cline, Karen Carpenter, Laura Branigan, they all passed away in their 30s, I believe.
Mm.
So,
she was older than that, but yeah.
Who was?
Donna Summer. She was older
than that. Yeah, yeah. 30s, but yeah. Laura Branigan, I think, was only like 38.
Oh, yeah. She was younger.
And
Patsy Cline was younger, yeah.
She was about 33.
Mm-hmm.
That's Amish. Such shame, because they were such talents.
All and the youngest of them all, the French heroine who was killed at 14, burned to the stake, Joan of Arc, 14. That's very young.
Was that her age? She was that
14,
young?
Yes, she was 14.
Just because of her precognition or psychic gifts, she was thought to be a witch. And
yes.
That's how stupid people were then. How primitive in their beliefs.
You stick to your beliefs, and that's all you know.
How many innocent people were killed just for political gains? And anyway, that's a whole other topic. We could do a whole other podcast on. Anyway, last program we have is another rarity. Paul Wing and his magic typewriter. There's more than just one of these in existence right now, of course. We're presenting Chapter 1, The Voyage Begins. And from Saturday, June 16th, 1934, over from the NBC syndicated service. And I don't have any cast information available on this. I am very sorry. But I think there was, if I can get my magnifying glass here, there was one note that I had made here. This recording might be a little bit noisy, so we hope you'll bear with us on that. There's no open or close here, though that's been trimmed. And there's a couple, there's an unintentional drug reference in this one. Eat the cookies and get small. I mean, you can kind of take what you want from that,
Alice
but
in Wonderland.
I'm not sure how it was.
Eat the cookies and get small, because she did. She ate the cookie and she shrunk real small, and that's how she got the little door. I understand the connotation perfectly.
Okay, you do then, because yes. I've never read Alice in Wonderland.
She gets big in some parts by eating things, and she gets small in other parts, depending on what she ate.
I've seen the adult version of it, but, you know, and that's a whole other thing.
Ooh, that really is a Wonderland, though, isn't it?
Yeah, we won't talk about that here on this program, because this is a family show.
Mm-hmm.
If you happen to come from a broken family. But anyway. okay, I've given you all the details. Now, Steve has a very small bit of information we have
two
on...
two paragraphs on this one. This is such a rare show.
Paul Wing and his
magic typewriter. Yes. Paul Wing and his magic typewriter, magical typewriter, was a children's serial about the adventures of Peter and Patsy, who, with Paul Wing, who has been turned into a cat, get miniaturized by eating magic cookies and embark on a sea voyage with Captain Better to the United States of Merriment. The serial came from the NBC syndicated service and ran for 39 15-minute episodes from June 16, 1934 to March 9, 1935. The serial was usually heard on Saturday mornings. That's okay. Usually when I have my cereal.
That's all we got.
Saturday morning.
That's all we got on that. And, you know, there's been a couple other shows that we featured here. The Mandrake the Magician and The Magic Island have no traditional open and closing credits. That's just the way they survive to this day. So we're only giving you what is available, what we can. So such is the case with this one, too. But it should still be enjoyable to you. And please forgive it's a bit of a noisy recording, but we hope you'll bear with us through it. Steve, are you ready?
I am indeed.
All righty, we're going for chapter one here.
There. Chapter one starts off right there in that position, and it's coming through, I see. Okay.
All right, so close your eyes and remember back to your childhood. Paul Wing and his magic typewriter. Chapter one, The Voyage Begins, from Saturday, June 16, 1934, over the NBC syndicated service.
Just as I told you, fixing that old typewriter.
Say, let's make him quit.
Yes, and tell us a story.
Here. How do you expect me to do any work?
We don't expect you to.
No, indeed. We expect you not to.
Well, but how do you expect me to earn the money to buy my bread and butter if I don't do any work?
Couldn't we do your work tonight after we've gone to bed? Couldn't we?
Oh, no, Patricia. I've got to finish this story right now.
Say, Paul.
What is it, Peter?
What's that?
What's what, Peter?
That, there on your table.
Why, you know what that is. That's my magical typewriter that all my stories come out of.
Sure we know what it is. And that's why we want you to tell us a story right now.
Yes, we want you to take us on a magical voyage.
Oh, no, really, Patsy. Really, Peter. I've got to work right now. Some other time.
Aw, please. Couldn't you take us on a magical voyage now and do your work tonight?
No, Patsy. Aww. I don't see how I could possibly do my work tonight. And anyway, suppose I could do my work tonight. Where would you want me to take you on this magical voyage?
Oh, we don't care where. We just want you to take us, don't we, Peter?
Yes, that's exactly what we want.
No, I couldn't possibly spare the time.
Oh, yes, you can.
Come on, let's get started.
Oh, I couldn't think of it. Say, listen. Listen, what's that?
What?
I don't hear anything.
Right over there at the window. Now listen.
Gee whiz, it sounds like water.
What? Water? Why, that couldn't be. There's no water outside my window.
Well, just the same, that's what it sounds like. Let's go and see what it is.
Yes, come on, let's look.
Yes, go ahead. I'm coming.
Say, it is water.
A whole ocean of it.
I should say it is.
Right up to the windowsill.
Well, I never saw such a thing in my whole life.
Look. Here comes a boat. A lovely little yellow boat with bright blue sails. Oh, it's beautiful.
Say, that is a beautiful boat. Why, Peter, it's almost exactly like the one you got for Christmas last year.
Yes, but look at that funny little man steering the boat. He's wearing a tall silk hat.
Yes, and carrying an umbrella and a handbag.
Well, what a funny bag. It's made of carpet.
Why, Peter, how tiny he is. He can't be any taller than...
No taller than your shoe top.
No, sir, no taller than your shoe top.
Look, he's steering the boat right up to the windowsill.
He's going to land here.
Hey, you in the window. Stand by to catch this line.
He's saying something to us.
What was it he said? Could you hear, Patsy?
He wants you to catch the rope he's going to throw.
All right, go ahead and throw it.
Here it comes.
There, I've got it.
Now pull the boat in and hold it there while I get up the sails down.
All right.
There, now get your hands off the windowsill so as I can jump onto it. That's it. Well, how do you do?
Why, I'm pretty. I'm...
Well, I wouldn't exactly call you pretty, but you're not bad looking. Your sister's really prettier than you are. How are you, my dear?
Why, thank you, I'm pretty. I mean, I'm very...
Of course you are. Very pretty. And how do you do, too, I suppose? Why, I'm very well, thank you. In fact, we're all very well, all three of us. Of course you are. Why, you'd be very foolish if you weren't.
I hope you're well, too.
Yes, indeed I am. In fact, I'm better.
Oh, goodness, have you been sick?
Certainly not. I'm never sick.
But you said you're better.
I am better.
Better than what?
Not better than anything. Just better. You see, that's my name. I'm Captain Better.
Oh, I see.
What a funny name.
It is not a funny name. It's as good a name as there is. In fact, it's better.
Oh, please. I didn't mean it wasn't a good name. I meant it's nice and funny.
Oh, well, if that's what you mean, I don't mind. And anyway, I guess we better not stand here arguing about names when we got so far to go.
Hooray, are we going somewhere?
Why, of course we are.
Oh, my, where are we going, Captain Better?
Well, I overheard you just a moment ago saying you wanted him there, to take you on a magical voyage. And when he said he couldn't, why, of course, I came to take you on one myself. So that's where we're going. We're going to the United States of Merriment. That's where I live.
Oh, that sounds grand.
I'll say so. Is it
fun? Will we be away overnight?
Will we sleep on your boat?
Wait. Now, wait a minute. I'll answer your questions one at a time. Yes, yes, yes.
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, yes, it is far. And I mean, yes, we will be away overnight. And I mean, yes, we will sleep on my boat. And in many other places, too.
Gee, that's great.
It's perfectly wonderful. Oh, but Captain Better, we're much too big to get on your boat.
Gosh, that's right. I never thought of that.
I guess we can't go. We can't possibly get on that little tiny boat.
Oh, nonsense. Of course you can. All you need to do is to swallow one of my make you small cookies. Here, wait till I get them for you out of my carpet bag. There, one for you and one for you. I invented them myself. Now go ahead and eat them.
Are you sure they won't make us too small, Captain Better?
Yes, or anything else?
Oh, quite sure. You see, I didn't invent them to make you too small or anything else. I invented them to make you just small enough and nothing else. Go ahead and eat them and see how quick you'll be small. Oh, but say, you'd better sit down on the windowsill or you'll never be able to reach up to it after you eat them. Go ahead, sit down on the windowsill and eat them. You needn't be afraid. I'll give you one of my Get Big Again cookies after we get home.
You think you should, Peter?
Sure, let's do. Come on, sit here beside me on the windowsill. Well, here goes.
Oh!
What's the matter, Patsy?
I never felt so funny in my whole life.
I never felt so good in my whole
That's
life.
That's what I mean, funny and good.
Well,
both at the same time. My, but you look little.
Yeah, but so do you. And everything in the room looks terribly big. Gee, I'd hate to fall off this windowsill. Look how far it is to the floor.
My, it makes me dizzy.
Well, come on, then. Come on, jump aboard my boat, and we'll be off. Come on, we're wasting time.
All right, Captain. Come on, Patsy.
Come on. Climb down the way Peter did.
Here I come. Look out, I'm going to jump.
Fine. Now then, let's get going. You'll have to lend a hand, though.
All right, we're ready. What should we do?
Here, Captain Better. You're forgetting all about me. I want to go, too.
You? Say, you can't go. No grown-ups are allowed on this magical voyage. Grown-ups can think of too many things you mustn't do. No, you can't go.
Oh, I won't think of anything you mustn't do.
No, you can't go. No grown-ups allowed.
Really, Captain Better, Paul won't make any trouble at all. He won't think of anything we mustn't do.
Well, he can't go as he is. Maybe we could let him go if he'd let me turn him into something else.
Why, sure I would, Captain. I've been the way I am all my life. It'd be fun being turned into something else. What could I be, Captain Better?
Well, let me see. I tell you, how would you like to be the ship's cat? I haven't got one, and I've always wanted a ship's cat called Thomas. How would you like that?
Fine, if you'll let me go along.
All right, here. Let me get you one of my turn-you-into-a-ship's-cat cookies out of my carpet bag. It's another of my inventions. Now catch it. That's it. Now sit down in the windowsill and eat it.
Oh, doesn't he look funny?
Isn't he black?
Come on, Thomas. Come on, climb aboard. Isn't he a fine cat, though? That's it. Now let's get started.
Oh, good. We want to get started. Come on.
All right, then. But you'll have to help me get the sails up again.
Hey, that'll be fun.
Will you help too, Patsy?
Oh, I'd love to, Captain Better.
All right, then I'll show you how to do it.
What shall I do?
What shall I do?
Can I pull on a rope?
Which one shall I pull on?
Here. There you go again, asking so many questions that I can't answer them.
Oh, then you tell us what to do, will you, Captain?
Yes, sir, that I will. Now, Peter, you go forward up there by the mast.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead, and I'll tell you what to do.
All right, Captain.
Here I am. I'm ready.
Now, you see that rope hanging down there?
This one?
That's right. Now, you pull down on that rope. That'll raise the jib, that little sail up there. And while he's doing that, Patsy,
yes, sir?
You and I'll pull on these two ropes.
What do they do, Captain?
Well, when you pull on them long enough, they raise the mainsail. That's what they do. Now then, you ready?
Oh, yes, sir.
Here we go, then.
My, it's hard, isn't it?
Oh, not so very. Mm. When you could choose to be in a sailor, we'll have the mainsail up in just a jiffy now. Yes, sir, less than a jiffy. There, it's up now.
Oh, and Peter has a little sail up, too.
Yeah, now what shall I do, Captain?
Not a thing, Peter. We're all ready to sail. Oh, but say, wait a minute. We've lost our breeze.
Oh, dear. Where did we lose it?
Well, that's just the trouble. I don't know. So I don't know where to look for it, Patsy.
What shall we do, Captain?
I tell you, I'll try whistling up the mast.
Will that make the breeze come back?
Yes, sir, Patsy. If you whistle long enough, it's sure to.
Couldn't we do anything to help?
Sure you can. You can sing while I whistle.
What do we sing, Captain?
Say, how would it do if we sang Sailing, Sailing? We know that song.
Fine. You couldn't sing a better song to get a breeze. And while you sing it, I'll whistle it. There now, you all ready? Now.
Sailing, sailing over the bounding main. So many a stormy wind.
Here, wait a minute. This will never do. We'll never get a breeze unless you all sing.
But we were all singing.
Oh, no, you weren't. Thomas wasn't a singing. Now then, let's start over again. And this time, you sing too, Thomas.
No.
Now then.
Sailing, sailing, over the mountain now.
Now we can sail all right. Peter, you take the wheel. I'll tell you which way to steer it.
All right, Captain Better.
And Patsy, you go back there and cast off that stern line when I sing out.
All right, Captain.
And Thomas.
Yeah.
You pick up that rope that's coiled on deck, and if I say, haul on your main sheet, you pull in on it.
No.
That's right, but if I don't. Now I'll go forward and cast off the bow line. Now then, you all ready?
All ready, Captain.
Yes, sir, all no. ready. And here we go. Cast off your stern line, Patsy. Haul in your main sheet there, Thomas.
No.
Now, Peter, roll her down to port. No, the other way. That's right. Here we go. Hey, look at those sails
sail
up. Oh,
isn't it fun? I should say it is.
Pull under the wheel, Peter.
Isn't that great? Look at the wind fill those sails. There's
hey,
a boat.
Great. Great.
Hey, I'll bet we have a great time on this voyage, don't you? Because I like boats. And say, I expect there'll be plenty of excitement on that sail. So you meet me right here at your radio for our next story, and we'll see what happens. Now, our announcer will tell you when that'll be. Goodbye until then, boys and girls. Goodbye.
Howdy, folks. This is Will Sugarfoot Hutchins. You are now listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
And welcome back to The Glowing Dial. This is episode Pod 77, where Steve and myself celebrate Labor Day and sing Whoa Ho Ho, It's Magic. And you just heard the last magical program for this particular episode, Paul Wing and his magic typewriter. Chapter 1, The Voyage Begins. And that's from Saturday, June 16, 1934, over the NBC syndicated service. We have come to the end of another episode.
The end of the magic now, huh?
Yes, indeed.
Hmm.
But before we go and give you our usual reminders, I want to tell you what's coming up in the next episode of The Glowing Dial. Yes, episode Pod 78 will be premiering September the 9th of this year, 2018. And Steve and I are going to present our tribute to science fiction on radio. Of course, we're going to have all the celebrity birthdays, and we're going to have episodes of Dimension X, X-1, 2000 Plus, and Tales of Tomorrow. Now, Tales of Tomorrow, They did a short radio version, but there's a more extensive version of it on TV from the early days of live television. And they did some interesting stories then, too. Steve, if we ever have time to sit down and just catch something like that, maybe I'll show you one of those.
Uh-huh.
It's one called The Window, which was very creative for its day. And it was pretty cool of ABC and the sponsor to let them do it that way. More than that, I won't say, because I don't want to. I want you just to get the first impression of it without a lot of explanation.
Oh, all right, that's probably better that way.
Yeah, it is. And I think that episode features a young Rod Steiger. So
Rod Steiger.
Mm-hmm. And of course, I mentioned Steiger, and I have to mention Brad Steiger, the paranormal researcher and investigator and author. He passed away recently. We've had a whole list of celebrity passings. I was going to actually make a list here because you've emailed me about so many of these people, and I don't remember them all right now. I know Harlan Ellison, the science fiction author, was one of them.
He just died within the last week or so.
Yeah, and you notified me about five or six others.
Mm-hmm.
I just don't remember, but... It just happens to be one of those times where they all pass in quick succession. Because last year we lost a whole lot of people.
Mm-hmm. I usually only send you the ones that I know made a very big impression on you, John. So those are personal ones from me to you.
I appreciate it.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, that's that. So tune in for the next episode of The Glowing Dial. And I think that... Paul Whiteman and his orchestra are ready to materialize behind us here and give us our closing music. So are you there, Paul? All right, there's Paul Whiteman. So for now, folks, don't forget all the great ways you can listen to the Glowing Dial tri-weekly podcast. There's our own page at glowingdial.com, Jerry Hanniger's old-time radio network at otrsite.com, YouTube, Google Play Music, iTunes, the Internet Archive at archive.org, and TuneIn Radio, and more to come. Don't forget the Glowing Dial online bookstore through our association with Amazon.com. Make sure you click through there and do all your Amazon.com shopping through our bookstore. You'll help to support the show when you do. The Glowing Dial online store through our association with CafePress.com. Some great items and wearables with the Glowing Dial logos. And as soon as you guys start buying some of those, we'll design some new ones. Hint, hint. The Glowing Dial Archives. Well, that's on the Glowing Dial page. Just click on Archives on the menu. All past episodes are there for download in the MP3 format. Don't forget our Facebook page and our blog. We want to break 100 likes on our Facebook page, and we hope you'll help us do that, you and your friends who are interested in old-time radio and things nostalgic. And we get donations via PayPal currently. We have that set up on the main page. As little or as much as you can afford, you will be helping us here at the Glowing Dial with production of the show and equipment maintenance and all that good stuff. We're working on a Patreon page too, so stay tuned for that. Don't forget the Glowing Dial Live every third Sunday of the month. You can talk with us via our chat room, phone, and Skype, win cool prizes, and hear our audio-only feed as well as our YouTube and Facebook video feed, so you can see what these crazy people look like when we're doing the show. Lastly, we want to thank all of our sources of information that we give to you here on the show. Jerry Hanniger's Vintage Radio Logs, Wikipedia, OTRCat.com, and the good folks over at Digital Deli 2 who are doing a wonderful job. Just go over there and check them out. Drop them an email. Let them know what a great job they're doing. And John Dunning's opus work, On the Air, the Encyclopedia of Old-Time Radio, and its predecessor, Tune In Yesterday. I had that book perpetually out of the library in those days. So this is Big John.
And this is Steve.
And Steve. Yeah, there's some enthusiasm there. Keep a positive thought. Keep looking up. Think big. Keep watching the skies. And we'll see you on the radio. Until then, take care.